amazing. Like, what?
Now I gotta murder the murder to get away. The I get the kill, now the fools gotta pay. And if they pay, then they pay with their life. To watch another man try to hold on to a life. Cause I keep looking and hunting just like a lion. Let me suck a know that it's them that been dying. I show no remorse to the soul of a shadow. And if they tell, then the whole prepared a battle. I'll keep it coming and coming straight from my table. And if I miss, I'll never miss, I'll be the danger. I'm looking forward and I'm looking over my shoulder. And I'm making sale for sale to make the bonus. But I never rest and rest, so never cease. Until my motherfucking witness rest in peace. Cause what they saw, they never seen or even heard of. And if they live, it's just another body murder. Another body murder. Deals to make a kill, and anyone looking gonna get that ass killed. I'm living like a criminal, where criminal I be, and I'm respected in the hood like a G. But if they think about stitching, then they gone. I'm taking off their heads with the motherfucking crow. I gotta pay to play the play to get through, and I ain't through till I'm dumping on a fool. I see the fool running and running, but where they going? Had the wits in my murder, now they know it. Would they blast or blast or let them pass? I'll have to think that my life was going in a blast. If I wait to take it longer, that'll be my ass. Searching for these fools while stepping across the grass. Cause they get hard and hard, and that's real. And once you're just with it, with your eyes got you killed. Another body murder.
Respect my authority.
Bring your head to this. Another body murder. I'll have to get it together to watch your body get murdered. I'll have to get it together to watch your body get murdered. Bang your head. Come on. Bang your head. Bang your head. Bang your head to this. I see a fool wanna try and test the fool. I testify that the fool will have to lose. Fool, you try, better keep it low. Cause the brother that was shot with my motherfucking Uso. As I been with my head up, rallying prayers, I'm okay to fall out. And better get up. All these busters on my trail wanna get where I'm at, but they fail cause they can't fail. I keep failing. I've been staying my shit ever since they have me jailed in. But it ain't all about serving time. It's all about bringing down the bird and serving mine. Another pass, a pass in. You wanna pass by the rear, then the king start passing. All these fools throwing the face down. They gotta testify. They never get the reply. So how long can you land? When the gangster like the rear, keep smoking that ass. Bring your head to this.
Too near me. than what I say. I said I will shut that shit down.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are live!
For the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world on HBO pay-per-view, ladies and gentlemen, from Mandalay Bay, Las Vegas,
another edition of Thunderdome!
I wanna smash it up.
Respect my authority!
I'm trying to...
Finally, the Rock has come back!
My life's a little better now, but this I must confess. I wanna be a rebel. I wanna break some rules. Maybe they'll be yours. They might be my own. I wanna be a rebel. I can't get enough. I wanna be a rebel. I wanna smash it up.
Everything's so pleasant now, but sometimes I miss the mess. I'm on the straight and narrow now, but this I must confess. I wanna be a rebel. I wanna break some bones. Maybe they'll be yours.
We're not having a silly goose time right now. I'm legit pissed.
When the line froze, what did I see? A bad motherfucker standing next to me with his eyes closed, told he can't see. Trying to follow orders, just gone and be free. Be free like a bird, so today I'ma fly. Bad, bad motherfucker till the day I die. Be free like a bird, so today I'ma fly. Bad, bad motherfucker till the day I die. Yeah! Bad, bad motherfucker till the day I die.
I'm a bad brain Bruce Wayne in the fast. Couple J's in the ashtray, style
motherfucker.
Tattoo back, man. See the rap name. Take a bath in the champagne.
Wow, motherfucker.
Straight from the block, dog ducking shots. Walking to the stove, dollar four, black a mile,
motherfucker.
Blew up as a rock star, so I'm top floor throwing drinks
Oh, yeah. What's going on tonight? Friday night Smackdown. Starting to spend a lot of time on here. It's almost starting to feel like a gerb. But we are in campaign mode, and we are in the last week. 6 days remain, 1 week, basically, for Niobe Outbreak, number 3 on Kickstarter. Crooked Painter just broke the fourth wall. He confirmed he is in Deadpool 3. Crooked Painter. Jamie's here. I took a quick look at it. I saw Romulans. Romulans? Romulans. Remember that scene from the Star Trek 2008 movie? Kirk's face is all fucking fucked up. This vaccine McCoy gave him. And he's trying to say Romulans. No, I didn't think so. Where's the button? So yeah. We might have a special guest tonight. We might have a JD caller on here tonight. Just found out he is a member of the Antarctic Press Familia. Family, he's family now. JD Calderon. Deadpool 3, you saw Deadpool 2. I haven't seen any of them from start to finish. I've always seen them in piecemeal. Deadpool was always sort of an overhyped character to me. Just never really got on the Deadpool train. I mean, I was around when he first came out. He wasn't that special then. He looked kind of cool. That's all he kind of had going for him. Cable at that time was a far more interesting character. Even Domino. Bird Brain. Remember Bird Brain? You think they'll bring Bird Brain back in X-Men 97? Just to let you know, I am supporting Crooked Painter where as we speak tonight. I am dressed in my Eric July Blocked Me t-shirt. Made by the official sponsor of this channel. So there you go. Got the Eric July rocking here tonight. Because that is one of the topics. No, no K-pop. How about something like this? Yeah. What do you think, Snowball? One was cool. Aside from the baby dick scene, it was meh. Yeah. What do you think about X-Men 97? Have you had a chance to soak that in yet? I watched it again, the first episode, for the second time late last night. Just to see if I still felt the same. I still do. I think it's still good. I hear excellent things about part 3. That my mind died. Yeah, part 3 apparently is really fucking good. I was watching Angry Joe, and, you know, take what stock you have in Angry Joe, but I like Angry Joe, and I was watching Angry Joe, and Angry Joe has seen it, and they all three of them were fucking giddy over it, so I can't wait to see, because it has Madeline Pryor in it, right? The Goblin Queen, one of my favorite characters, man, one of my favorite ex-villains of all time. You got me. Just run with it and do a good gerb. We want to like things, you know? I want to like things. Do you want to like things out there? Or is it just hate culture now? I don't know. Is Eric July hating on crowdfunding? Apparently, you know, he is. I mean, I don't know the facts. I'm sure some people can start pointing me in the right directions in the chat. But I guess Shane Davis's wife did cut a video on him, like a wrestling promo. Might have to go look at that, see what's going on. Had a few topics for tonight's show. What else did I have lined up? Tom McFarlane, Spawn cover contest won by AI user. Now, we covered this to death, right? But Bleeding Cool is just sort of jumping on this now. They published an article yesterday talking about this situation. So we're going to have a look at that a little later tonight. That was an interesting one. Marvel's released its June 2024 solicits. That means all the new X-Men stuff. So we might take a scroll through that. And interesting, I don't know if we'll get into this or not, but Viz Media to republish manga adaptation of X-Men, the animated series. X-Men going manga, jumping on that X-Men animated series craze. Is that going to be enough to hook the younger generation? Manga, X-Men? I don't know. Food for thought. We had Nick Capone on last night. Nick Capone just launched Purity 2 on Kickstarter. Congratulations to Nick for a successful launch. He's got a goal of $6,850, I believe. It's a little lofty, not gonna lie. But it's Nick Capone, it's Purity, it looks great. Check it out. And if you can throw Nick a few shekels and get a great book in return, that's a win-win. Also, you may have seen this on the intro. This is a little ballsy of me, I gotta say, but in regards to Super Chats. First, that's the wrong thing. I'm a boomer.
Am I a boomer? BOOM! How about that? Am I a boomer? BOOM! BOOM! BOOM!
That's still the wrong one. How about this one? There we go.
Am I a boomer? BOOM! How about that? Am I a boomer? BOOM!
So, we want to thank everyone that has given us Super Chats. It truly does make the show worth doing. It gives us a glimmer of hope that, you know, people enjoy it enough to throw us a couple of shekels here and there. But if you throw us some big shekels, all right? If, because we haven't had this. No, we've, actually, that's a lie. We've had this happen once. $100 Super Chat from Riley. The Clipperverse. Shout out to Riley and Mint. We've had that happen once. But if should it ever happen again, while supplies last, I will mail you out cover B of Niobe the Trade paperback as drawn by Fern Cord of Mary Machine Gun fame. I'll show you the actual book in a bit. I got 5 of these. I mean, you would have to, you know, provide me with your mailing address, of course, for me to mail this to you. But I would do that on $100 Super Chat. So why 100? Because YouTube takes 30%. I don't know if people know that. YouTube takes a hefty cut, man. A hefty cut. So after they're cut, right? We're down to 70. I'm in Canada, so it's international shipping. You get the drill here, right? But, and it's just our way of saying thank you for you know, throwing us shekels. Because we, you know, like to give something back to people if we can in return. And we understand it's a donation, but much like on a Kickstarter, when you make a donation, you know, sometimes you get a reward. In most cases, right? But I got 5 of these kicking in a short box. So, that's why there's only 5 to get. And then once those have gone, then I'll change this into something else. But if you just throw us Super Chats, say, you know, a $5 Super Chat. We love those too. And we'll give away a digital comic book, a different one each month through the Niobe Library, including Savage Sin, Niobe Penguina. Everything but the latest, you know what I mean? $5 or more on a Super Chat, we will provide you with a Dropbox link where you can go ahead and download this. And not only that, but Sig and Joe from Warren Brown. It's a very animated style comic book that would remind you something of along the lines of Aqua Teen Hunger Force kind of vibe. That's also in the Dropbox. So just a couple of, you know, ways to claim a couple things here on the channel. Also, we have an online store. I don't talk about this enough, but we have a Shopify store. So niobecomics@myshopify.com. Or you can go to the YouTube channel and just click store in the tabs. And there's a handful of different Niobe goodies available there as well. I do got to update it with some new product. But go ahead and, you know, jump in on some of those as well. We also have an eBay store, a Gumroad store. So there's a, you know, variety of different ways to get a hold of Niobe. It's not just necessarily through Kickstarter. So we do encourage you to back. But NiobeComics@Gumroad.com. You can get Niobe on digital. Seems to be popular with everyone these days. Save on space, read on your devices. I see the appeal. We might be, you know, slowly, and I hate to say this, but we might be slowly moving out of the collector market for comics. It's not done yet, don't get me wrong, but I'm seeing less and less people buying physical copies these days. There does seem to be a digital trend. I don't know if that's strictly because of a financial reason, because digital comics generally are cheaper than their physical counterparts, or if it's just, you know, the sign of the times and the world is just going digital, period. However it goes, we'll be the last man on the ship. Check back in with Snowball. There we go. So I threw out the link. I'm on a little early for some people. But I was bored. I finished my script for my my submission to Mr. Ben Dunn for Ninja High School 200. A 10-page story that will open up into a much larger story should he decide he wants to run with that. But it is in his hands now. So I got that accomplished and finished late last night. Next is going to be Savage Sin 2. That's the next challenge. Get that done. And then straight on to Niobe Outbreak 4. Gotta chew through these one at a time. I'm excited for Savage Sin 2. You know, I keep, you know, Phil Leon keeps echoing in my ear that people have been asking about it. And I see it every now and then. But I think it's been a while, and I think we do need to get it out and get it moving. I'm cool on Marvel cartoons, says Crooked Painter. DC needs to start pushing Firestorm. Yeah, Firestorm's all right. I keep forgetting about Firestorm, to be honest with you, though. I remember him in the old Super Friends cartoon. Yeah. Well, let's see where we're at campaign-wise. Tales of the Tape. 244 Sexy Backers Strong. It says 7 days left to go, but that will switch to 6 in or around midnight. 13,175 Canadian Duck Bucks. That's approaching 10 grand US. And we still got, you know, the last week, and we've talked about this many times on the show, and that your last week is pretty much just as important as your first week, you know, in as terms of the amount of backers that you could potentially get. Right now, we, you know, we still got Saturday, pretty much all next week into Friday to run with this thing. And there's a lot of sort of last minute backers that pile in. And you'll start to see that in the last week. But more or less, as you get towards your last 3 days, the last 2 days, the last day, people will get these updates, these emails. They'll let them know, because every campaign has the followers, right? So if we were to see how many followers we got right now. So 390 followers, 60 converted followers for a conversion rate so far of 15%. Now, they say like a conversion rate like 25 and above is pretty good. You know, you get 25, 30, 35, 40, you know, percent of people converting. That's really good. And you'll see the conversion rate rise towards the end of the campaign as, again, these people who are following will get the updates and then decide if they're going to back or not. So you still stand to go up a little bit. It's not going to be anything crazy, but you know, we can still move forward with what we're doing here. And then straight on to Savage Sin. But also we're going to be doing the Niobe number 2 second printing. So we're going to be reprinting old Niobe. And we're going to throw it in color, give it a splash in color, some new lettering, a couple of new variant covers. People have asked to read these old issues. We're going to get them out there, but we're going to make them, you know, look proper and get those out into your hands. And that will be a like a sort of a maybe like a 3-week Kickstarter campaign when that's ready to go. But that will be a little while down the road. Yeah, not too far down the road, but a little while, a couple months. We're still setting up for everything. We're still coloring pages. Still some work to be done on this. But it is sort of going to be the next Kickstarter. Sort of what I would call like a side Kickstarter, you know, small Kickstarter. Just to get that one bouncing. All right. So we got someone in the back. Let's bring him on, man. It's been a little while since we've had JD Colleron come around, brother.
What's up, Larry? How you doing?
Man, I'm a little stoned, dude. You know, I've sort of been, I'm in like riding solo here, man. You know what I mean? I'm just trying to, you know, babble on about things, brother. You know, like.
Gotcha.
I'm used to having someone to bounce something off of. So you like, I've been left hanging for like a good 20, 25 minutes, and you made the save, brother. You know what I'm saying?
Gotcha. Where's Max?
Dude, that, isn't that like the number one question?
Yeah,
where is Maximus? I do know where Max is. Max is at home with the wife and kid. So, you know, not to dive too much into Max's personal stuff, but he's talked about this on air before. You know, we all know that Phil Leon was living with Max, right?
Oh, you know, I didn't know that. Okay.
Okay. Oh, wow. Okay. So there's a lot. All right. So the lore, back to lore, goes even deeper. So Phil had to move out of the house. His roommates were moving some family in. Phil was desperate for a place. Max said, "Hey, boss, come down and live with me, boss," right? So Phil packed up all his stuff and moved from, Indiana to Missouri, fucking Kansas, Missouri, and basically shacked up with Max for close to a year. But the thing is Max's situation has changed now, too. Max and his ex-wife are back together, and they're moving in together. And so Max has been getting all that ready, and they're getting a new townhouse or something to that line. So it's been a little while. It's been a week or so. Since we really spoke to him, but he's just getting his shit settled, and he said he'd be back in about a week or two.
him.
So yeah, the show's been a little bit different without Maximus. That, you know, like I miss my partner, man. I miss my, you know what I mean? Like, he's always been the one guy you can count on, you know, like.
He's been your rock.
The Rock, man. He's been the Rock, you know, from like WWE. Do you watch wrestling?
I used to. I was big into it back in the day. Like, I stopped watching probably about around the time The Rock left.
Okay. Well, The Rock is back and he's making waves, you know. Mm-hmm. Doing only what The Rock can do. Well, let's talk about you, brother, man. You've been the one thing about you, JD, and I'm talking strictly YouTube wise, is you are consistent as fuck, brother.
I try to be.
Man, I can always count that you will be on Sunday nights. You know what I mean? Same bat time, same bat channel, all the time, dude. How do you keep it? Like, I'm random as fuck right now because I actually, you know, I got to find a part-time job. I want unemployment right now and collecting unemployment insurance, and that's going to run out at some point, JD. So either comic books have to, you know, spring forward, or I got to spring backwards a little bit. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Believe me. I know. Scheduling. Because it's crazy, right? I just started a new job about 3 weeks ago.
Okay, right? Congratulations, brother.
Thank you. Now, what's funny is I was a manager at a big box store in Midtown Manhattan, right? And they have fired one of my coworkers, another manager.
Okay.
And it kind of pissed me off. No lie. And I was like, and I'd always said, if they fire this guy or this guy leaves, I'm leaving. So once I heard that, I was like, okay, cool. And they didn't fire him. They laid him off. They downsized his position. They gave him severance. You know, he's doing all right. He's going to find another job. But still left a bad taste in my mouth. But I was like, all right, cool. So I started looking, found something. And then I interviewed on Friday. Right?
Yeah.
And then on Monday, then Sunday, I went into work. We had this big meeting. There's all these changes and whatever. Okay, great. And then Monday, I find out they're closing the store.
Wow.
And then I had a second interview on Tuesday, and I got hired.
So either way, you were on the way out.
Yes. Either way, I was on my way out.
Yeah. That's how it was with my last job, because we all knew that our division was shutting down. It was just a matter of months of when, you know what I mean? And sure enough, I was right, you know. So it was no big loss there either, you know. So either way, I was out, right. You know.
Right. So, you know, I just got lucky in the sense that, you know, I started looking beforehand, and I got it. It's a much better job. It's a corporate job. And it's just weird. It's just very strange. Very strange.
Now, does this corporate job, like any of the experience you've had, you've only been there for a few weeks, but anything that you can parlay into comic books from a business point of view?
Yeah, because there's a lot of marketing stuff that I'm learning. There was some stuff about the wheel that I'm thinking of really looking into. It's very strange, not too abstract marketing tool that I'm going to look in a little bit further into, and then I'll start discussing it. But yeah. Because I don't know enough about it to really talk about it, but I might do a show. But what's funny is, like, it's going to be one of these shows where I'm going to send everybody's going to have to do homework before they come on the show because they have to watch a video.
Speaking of watching things, did you watch X-Men 97?
No. You know what's funny? I never got into it.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, never watched it. It was a strange period for me. Like, 97, I was in my 20s, and I was in the comic thing, but I was too busy doing my own stuff. I was like, at that time, look, I got a copy. I was doing this.
What is that? Hold on. Whoa! You're gonna get us canceled, JD.
Oh, no, you don't see anything. there's no nudity on there. I mean, if I opened it up, now that would do it.
Damn, man.
But that's actually the first comic that I wrote that was a paid gig. Like, that was my first professional work.
How did you land that, anyway?
Interesting story. Okay. So I was doing a book, Daphne, I, and this group of guys, Matt Lunsford, Zach Mladenson, or Winston, Anthony Johnson, Gerald Bart, all these different guys. We all got together. We formed this company called Golden Armor Limited. We did a bunch of books, Dreamweavers, Tall Tales, Reverb, did a bunch of stuff. Okay. Lasted for 2 or 3 years because we were a bunch of kids. We didn't know what the hell we were doing.
Sounds like me right now.
Right.
Right.
I mean, but listen, it's comics. We're always learning, so it doesn't matter. But once Golden Run was done, we were all kind of like lost. Like we were like in our early 20s, like 21, 22, 23, somewhere in that area. And Matt was like, you know, he had gone off. He had done some work for Antarctic Press. He was actually drawing Ninja High School. He did 3 issues for them.
Damn, right on, brother.
And then he was at a show, and somebody had come by. They saw his work. They were like, hey, you want to try out for this job? And it was for La Blue Girl. And I remember we were all on vacation in Miami, and we were going up to Disney World. And he was like, hey, guys, I got this opportunity, but it's to do porn. And I remember looking down my nose at him, and I was just like, porn? How dare you even bring that into my presence? God, it's disgusting. And then about 6 months later, he comes to me, he's like, Jose, they're looking for a writer. And I was like, throw my name in a hat. And they called me up. I went over. I interviewed for the job, just like you would interview for any job. And they read the comics that I had done with him in the past. We did 3 issues of Dreams, so they read, well, actually 4 issues. They read those. They liked what they saw. And they offered me the position. That was it.
Bada bing, bada boom, man.
That's it. You know?
So, you know, I'll tell you who else is consistent. Is your wife, Anita.
Yeah.
They are my part of my morning watch, JD.
Mondays and Fridays?
My Mondays and Fridays. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like between them and Ben Dunn right now, because they're pumping out videos like, you know, in the afternoon, around noon. You know, it's around noon for me when I notice them, right? Like I'm just right. Sort of waking up. I'm lying in bed. I got YouTube playing in the background. Oh, okay, someone's live or, you know, click on it, right? Mm-hmm. And so they're my morning watch, man. Right. And then Ben Dunn, but they're consistent, man. You know what I mean? I can always count on that too. You know, like you guys got the schedule of this thing down, you know? So what's brewing, man? Like you've been doing some interesting topics, man. And every time I see you go live, I'm like, God damn it, man. I want in, you know what I mean? Like,
well, like, you're in this Sunday. So.
Yeah, I know. I'll get my chance, coach. You know what I mean?
You're in the sun.
But you like you got so much interesting topics. I'm just trying to find your channel right now. So like while I got you here, I can go over a couple of these topics and you can sum up maybe can you give me a link to your channel? Because I'm like I have to scroll through my subscriptions to find it. And guys, I'm going to put the link into the chat. So if you're not subscribed to JD here, man, please go ahead and take care of that. Right meow. You know what I'm saying? You guys send that in a private or Facebook.
Oh yeah. I'll put it in the private chat.
There we go. Boom.
Yeah, man. I mean, you know what it is? It's right. The things with YouTube, right? You either have to be entertaining or educational, right? So that's what I always heard. So I figured I'd try to be as educational as possible. You know, try to help people out, you know. And, you know, oh God, no. That music. It's cool, but.
All these are like 3 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. Click on live.
Oh, it's all live. Okay.
No. Because you're on videos.
Yeah, I know. I got you. I want to see what you were doing in the past here. Now, let's look at JD as it was back in the day. Now that you got me down this rabbit hole, brother. So you were doing a lot of review videos, it looks like. This one here, Patriotica. That's another book published by AP currently. What made you stop?
Yeah. If you scroll to the top, you can stop that video.
What's that?
Scroll to the top.
Yeah.
I think it's almost over. It's this. It's that video that's playing.
I don't understand what we're talking about.
No, no, no. There's a video playing in the background. That's why I don't know. Oh, wait a second. I'm sorry. That's me. Because I'm like, what?
I'm tripping out, dude. What are you doing, man?
I'm like, why does he not hear that? Because I turned on my. All right.
We good now?
See, you're the one smoking and I'm the one bugging.
Right. No, it's good, man. All right. Like I was saying, though, 3 years ago, you were doing review videos. I didn't know this.
Yeah. I did a lot of review videos. And what's funny is I had one guy, I was doing these just pretty much exclusively, and I had one guy say, hey, can I come on your show? And I was like,
show?
Sure. I was like, okay. And I interviewed him, and then I started interviewing people. And that was one at a time, and I probably did that for about a year. And then I started, like, during the height of COVID, when everybody was locked down, I was still working. But I was only working like 4 or 5 hours a day, and I would come home and I would just have a lot of dead time. And I was just like, all right, because I would write for an hour or two. But even then, that's my pattern. I write for an hour or two every day. It's not a thing about writing 8 hours a day, because that would just drive me nuts. But, you know, so then I got into doing the panels, where it's just like just inviting in a bunch of people. But yeah, I used to do these all the time.
It's interesting that you're doing the preview magazine.
Yeah. Because I looked at it like this. I go through it every month religiously. And
still to this day?
Still to this day. Every month, man, I go to my home.
And you would have seen me in there, brother.
Yeah, you're in there.
I am in there, man.
You know? But I stopped doing those because they just weren't getting any views. I was just like, nobody's really watching it.
You know, yeah, I mean, if we look at it, 21 views 4 years ago. But I, you know, here's the thing, though. I haven't seen anyone do this, like, with a previews magazine. And I almost think it's important to have out there, even if no one is really watching them. Just, I don't know, just to have a record, like, here's the stuff that is available that you can get that you may not even know about. Because, you know... Mm-hmm. You're a guy who's gonna peruse through this. When I have one in my hand, I always go through it, right? Not every month, but when one comes across my way, I definitely like flipping through it, you know, mm-hmm. just to see what's out there that I didn't even know about, you know. It's like my problem is it's like window shopping. I'm not picking 10 or 11 things I just can't afford to buy. You know what I mean? Like
right, yeah.
Yeah, because
I'm a degenerate. I'm always buying a bunch of stuff.
So like, you know, it's not just comics, as you guys can see here while we're watching. There's statues, there's toys, there's t-shirts, there's knickknacks, paddy wax, you know what I mean? Like kind of everything. The reason why I stopped on this one, I was wondering if I'm actually in this one.
No, that's an older one. It was 4 years ago.
Yeah, I know.
That's an older one. Yeah. And that's also you see Skeletor, that's Daphne set up. Oh my, I heard that.
Oh yeah, this is before my time for sure. Look, Action Lab is still in the magazine. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, I just to have a look and see what's going on in the world of comics, because there's more to comics. Because the people who will watch a channel like mine or maybe even yours would only think of in terms of when they think indies, maybe in terms of crowdfunding, right? Because that's what a lot of us do. You know what I mean? And on your show, you've been talking a little bit about the direct market lately.
Yeah.
So what's going on? Are the wheels turning in your head? What's happening here?
Well, the wheels have never stopped turning. You know, the only difference now is that I'm coming through to the end of a cycle of my work, right?
Okay.
So the original thing is you see how many Oswald campaigns I put out, like boom, 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 you know?
Yeah.
So the original deal is like I have the first 8 issues. So there's a Passing Queen, there's a My First Day, and it is Passing Queen Making Homes. That's the first 8 issues. They're all done. I did them all in black and white. Then I put out trades, and then the next step is to put them out in color, right? And then I'm gonna put those out through Kickstarter. And then once I'm done with that, I'm looking to go into the direct market. So that's the next phase. So hopefully I'm looking to get through that phase this year. and then hopefully either later this year, but probably first quarter next year, I'm going to be moving into the direct market with the Oshawa Chronicles, and we'll see how that rolls.
Now let's now when you say that though, are you saying, because we had talked a little bit offline, you had mentioned Antarctic Press, is that the, you know, the route you're going, or are you like going to publish through Diamond yourself, or what's the plan?
I haven't decided yet. That's the thing. I haven't decided yet. Because we like I told you, Tall Tales is going to go back into furlough once Ben starts doing furlough. So we've already spoken to Ben. We've already sent him the material. So he has the stuff. So whenever they're ready to put it out, it'll be in there.
Perfect. I'll get it when it comes out, brother.
Thank you. And I mean, and as far as Oswald, I haven't decided yet, because I have to see, you got to remember, it's a different game, you know, like I've already had my hand in that game.
Many moons ago.
But printing and publishing, like, okay, so it's weird because I'm pretty sure you've seen Ben's statement, like, you know, as far as like, you know, what type of numbers to expect. When you go into printing,
yeah, right?
This is pretty much across the board. It's not just him. This is Scout involved in all those companies. They're all pretty much around the same thing.
Yeah, ballpark. Yeah, right? I would say that's right. Yeah.
But you know, my thing is like, I know there's a number, right? 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, right? Now 5,000 is a tough number in today's market. It's not impossible. But it's possible. 2,000, 3,000, a little bit more possible. But those numbers can be achieved. Now, how do we achieve
it? Already done it.
Right. No, I know you've done it. Right. But you got to remember, I'm coming in. Right. So I'm figuring out, okay, how can I get to this? How can I get past this? How can I get to the most thing? So that's why I'm having all the conversations about.
I don't think you're going to have a hard time, man, with that, you know? I think these new books that are coming into AP and the new stories and sort of this direction that they're shifting into is been a positive one so far. I think slowly but surely more people are taking notice, especially when we look at Tom Hutchinson and Critter. He's bringing in a lot of new eyes, just him alone, you know, because people still remember Critter fondly. You know, I still remember Critter fondly from back in the day, you know what I mean? So that's a big acquisition as far as, like, we're looking at it in wrestling terms, you know, and we got ourselves a star, you know. And I was talking to him last night. He was on the show and he was saying, you know, how he felt that AP did give him a boost in his campaign. He couldn't find any other reason why other than maybe dumb luck, he said, you know what I mean? But he said, if I had to attribute it to something, it's got to be this new exposure we're getting, you know. And he said, I've had people come up who read Critter back in the day and they didn't even know it was still around. They didn't know what Kickstarter is. It's just stuff like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it all matters, right? You know, are we ever going to be, you know, we joke and say the next Image Comics, right? Right. And I've heard your wife bash on that so much, brother.
Oh, <yeah.
laughs> you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
But what we mean by that though is honestly just like being a group of creator-owned guys banding together underneath one sort of flag, you know, and making a push for the goal, you know, that had nothing to do with being we were superstars and we think that we're going to sell millions of comics. It's all about creating a company that has the, you know, the creators have the rights. They don't have to sign away anything. They can do their Kickstarters. They can do their stuff. You know, and still have a place on the shelf. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And guess what, man? This is great. We got a special guest in the back. Now, I want you gentlemen to behave, okay?
Oh, you don't have to behave on my part.
All right.
What's up, Ben? How you doing?
We're all one big happy space fleet here.
That's it, man. I told JP he's family now, brother. You know what I mean? He's my familiar now, man.
Welcome to the family.
Yeah, thank you.
Never leave now.
So what's up, Ben? What's going on with you?
Oh, well, my wife's out of town, so I thought, oh, I saw your show. I said, you know what? I should drop in and see what's going on.
Well, we got JD Collar on, man, hanging out with us for a little bit.
Oh, yes, I'm familiar with JD. He's a good guy.
Yeah, I hear Tall Tales is coming to AP, Ben.
Well, hell yeah.
Tell me about that. How you know? Tell me where it's going to end up. When you expect to see it? Give us the goods, brother.
Well, I think I have it for furlough. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a great, fantastic furry story, and I just think that's the kind of thing we need for the title, because that'll really make sales jump.
Yeah, man.
Absolutely. Besides, I got a good eye for good stuff.
Well, you know, JD's been in the game for a long time, my brother. You know what I mean?
I know.
He's one of these.
All getting old.
Man, well, yeah. You know. There's a group of us that came in what I would call in the Kickstarter era, but JD's been doing this in the early 90s, just like you've been, just slugging it out, brother. You know what I mean?
Oh, hell yeah. Yeah, we're all grizzled veterans.
Grizzled veterans, man, you know.
That's right. Yeah. We're victims, we were soldiers in the indie wars.
So, yeah. Ben, I sent you a script today. You have it in your email now.
Oh, great.
Yeah, I'll tell you this about it. It's 10 pages. I cut it down a page, so it's an even number. Flows a little better. Anything that you see that you want to change in it, by all means, change it. You know what I mean?
Oh, well, I wouldn't do that.
No. If you got like, man, you're like, you know what? She wouldn't say this or she wouldn't do that. Then you carte blanche, man. You're the editor of this story. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, I appreciate that, but. You know, I like to have sort of like a Stan Lee, Jack Kirby relationship, you know?
Well, the only thing is, you know, and I don't know what you want to do with it. Whatever you choose to do with it, if anything, is awesome. But I think, you know, the way that I got it laid out, it could open the door for more, you know, obviously, right? That door is wide open.
Absolutely.
But wherever you
have a script.
Well, we have a script. What we don't have is an artist.
Yeah. Well, once I read the script, then maybe I'll find you an artist.
We only need 10 pages. You know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
And Nick Webb said he would color it.
Well, that's awfully nice of Nick.
Yeah, but I'll give Nick some money for that. You know what I mean?
Well, we'll work something out.
And then, you know, but since it's only 10 pages, it's not its own book yet. So it would have to go in the back of something. You know what I mean?
Well, you never know. Sometimes you get these things and you find out, wow, you know, there could be more to this, you know. And the next thing you know, you've got like a 96-page graphic novel.
Ah, Ben, I have a hard time getting out 24-page floppies, man.
You could do it if you really wanted to.
There you go.
JD, you have so many interesting topics, and it's good to have Ben here. You know, being a publisher, he can weigh in on some of this stuff.
Yeah, we can share war stories, man.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, the latest one you just did, the direct market and how indie creators join in and thrive. What not a better person to talk about that with than Ben Dunn. So let me ask you first, JD. I watched some of that stream. I didn't watch all of it, but I caught some of it because Ben was on it. Yeah. How did you feel, you know, after that stream, and you know, what did you learn? What did you pick up, man?
Well, I mean, I think because one of the things that I've been discussing, and I don't know, one of the things I'm looking at right now to do, right, as a publisher, is I was talking to Randy Zimmerman, and one of the things he did that was very interesting. He did it in Detroit, or excuse me, Flint, Michigan. He did it in Flint, and it was like a newspaper-style thing. Think Comic Shop News. I'm pretty sure if you go to a comic store, you'll sometimes see them. It's like a little paper that
absolutely
has like a circular. So, and I'm like, why don't we have one of those for indie comics? Right? They're actually not that expensive to print. And if we get 10,000 of them, like I said, it's not that expensive to print. I got to figure out distribution. And it has to be the sort of thing where the point of entry is very inexpensive, if nothing, for the retailer, right? And it has to go to stores, and only to stores, that are supporting indie comics. And that's what I'm looking at. Because the thing is right now, we're on Kickstarter, Indiegogo, whatever. We're micro-publishing. Right?
Yeah.
We're micro printing. We're 100 copies, 200 copies, 300 copies, 400 copies, 500. That's micro print.
Yeah.
That's all that is. And it's never going to get us any real eyeballs because we have our communities and they're fantastic and they're great. But it's limited to that. And I know there's a much larger community. It's out there. The only way we can reach them is through print. And by maybe doing this sort of thing, if I can get enough support from the rest of the community, and it's going to be a buy-in situation, but it's going to be a very low buy-in, right? To the point where it's like, look, here's the thing. If you can't afford it, you got bigger issues. You should not be publishing. You should not be printing indie comics. You should be doing something else, getting your life straight. You know what I mean? Because it'd be a very low buy-in. And trying to get that out to as many shops as possible into the hands of indie comic buyers. So imagine if you could get that into 10,000 indie fans who collect comic books, physical comic books, getting that and then looking at this stuff that we've been doing for years.
Years, John, years.
Exactly. And, you know, not just for Kickstarter, but through previews and through the whole nine, because I'm not going to exclude one or the other. I'm going to open it up to both, you know, the direct marketing and, you know, crowdfunding.
Right.
So that people can see this stuff that's going on through the markets. Because here's the thing. If it's not in front of people, people don't know about it. Right. Like, where the hell do we get news? Like Scout produces like 40 comics a month.
Mm-hmm.
AP produces 10 or 12 comics a month. Where are we hearing about this stuff? In previews. And nobody looks at it. I feel I'm the only person that really looks at it. You know, I mean, I'm sure there's three or four other weirdos out there just like me. They're all looking through it. But that's it. I talk to retailers. They don't even go through the whole catalog. Right?
No, so the physical catalog for sure, but they also can just order the books online, right? And some of these retailers, like you said, they're not looking at the smaller indies. You know, one of the big things that, you know, I think AP and Ben, you know, is the perfect person to touch upon this, is getting more shops to open their doors to these smaller press companies and give us a shot. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, and the thing is it's not even so much the shops, it's the fans. We have to get the fans to ask the retailers, because I guarantee you go to any store, right? And you go to the person that owns that store and say, can you get me this? If they're in that business, all right? You're not going to go into a shoe.
I love where this is going, because it's not true, right? But you keep going.
Well, no. If you walk into a shoe store, right? You're not going to ask them to get you a steak, right?
Fair enough.
But if you walk into a shop that sells exclusively Marvel and DC, you do not ask them for indie comics, because they're just not going to get them, right? But if you walk into a shop that does support indie comics and you have a pull list in there and you ask them for XYZ, they will probably get that book. And the more fans that ask for it, the more they're going to get it.
I know my shop does. I've seen people tell me, though, that the shops just won't get AP for whatever reason. It's not just AP, but other small comics, right? Some shops got a rule. If we're going to get one, we want to at least get five. And, you know, we don't want to get five, or whatever the case may be. But I do have, man, I hear you. We got to get more people. My biggest thing is, if your shop doesn't carry AP, ask them to at least get this title in your pull list. Like, my shop will carry AP, but they don't carry everything AP. Right. So when they got me Critter, they actually didn't order for the shelf. They just got it for whoever asked for it. You know what I mean? Which was me, you know? But the shop owner was right there when I was telling my buddy, who also works at the shop, what this book is. I'm like, you know, actually, they used to be with Aspen. This is Tom Hutchinson. You know, this goes back this day. And he looked at me and he looked at the book and, you know, kind of looked at me. He's like, huh. You know, it's like, oh, shit, maybe I should have gotten some for the shelf. You know what I mean?
Right. You do. Yeah. But that's what I'm saying. Like, if there's a vehicle, right, that can present this stuff to the fans, because right now there is no vehicle. Right, we have the stuff we're doing online, but it's very limited. The reach of my show, your show, Daphne's show—you put all those fucking shows together. What do we reach?
A couple
thousand people, if even.
Well, I do want to say that in regards to the show, you know, you're right. You know, in the grand scheme of things, it's peanuts, right? But in regards to this show in particular, I want to thank people for coming in to this. We've gotten like 10 new subscribers overnight, dude.
Nice.
which is small peanuts, again, in the grand scheme of things, but a pretty big leap for this channel. And it's because of this video here.
I put the link in my local bathroom.
Is that what happened?
On the back of the stall.
Anybody taking
a dump is just, yeah.
You don't know what video you're going to put out that people are going to gravitate to on YouTube, right? I do these short videos now, JD. Sometimes I clip my live show and I'll put those clips up, right? This Red Sonja one was actually when I was live and it was just me and I kind of made the segment. But it's at 1,300 views now, right? So people are coming in because of this video and they're subscribing to the channel. You know what I mean? And you can see all these other videos. Maybe they got 60, 200, 200, you know, anywhere from 100 to 2 or 3. You know what I mean? Yeah. But you'll have like one video, you know, like this Eric July one that will bring in people into the channel, you know. Yeah. Rob Liefeld, he was a popular topic. you know what I mean? And so this is actually growing our channel right now. We're at 1,089 sexy subscribers. It only goes up every 10 now. So like when we hit 1090, then it will switch. You know what I mean?
Can I ask a question about the content and the audience, the audience that it's going to? Now that, you know, we have Ben, JD, what's up? You know, you Larry.
What's up, Pete?
Hey, what's up? The question, and I've always had this question. I think I've always said, I've been pretty on brand by always saying it. I don't consider myself a comic guy. I'm going to self-publish a book again. I used to self-publish books. If people hire me for something cool, I'll do it. But I'm just a guy who likes to draw stuff. I mean, Jesus, I'm doing these things again. You know, I'm drawing on walls again, you know?
Dude,
like left and right. It's crazy. It's got stickers everywhere. That's why Larry's subscriptions are going up. I got the Niobe ones all over the bathroom.
That's it.
But anyway, my question is, and I see some people's shows are geared towards their group or the demographic of indie creators or people who are like in the indie industry. You know, I won't say names or anything like that, but like that. And then I see some shows that aren't. They're just kind of like talking about the stuff that's going on. And you get a little inside baseball and whatever. But the question is, are you guys actively looking to just stay in, or do you think people are just too stuck, or they're actively looking to stay just in, just to get their views and their stuff from indie creators or the indie fans, or do they want to break that wall and go after the fans that, you know, don't even know about what indie or indie YouTube is and get actual, because that's the big group of people, the untapped people, the group of fans that just read comic books.
That's a long question.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's I had to get there.
I want to sum it up in a little bit. Are you saying that like me, Ben, JD, whoever, a lot of our crowds and the people that would follow us primarily, and I think I said this at the beginning of the show, are like crowdfunding comic book fans, you know what I mean? And that there's like tons of people out there, like you said, that are just comic book fans, and I think those people who are comic book fans go to comic book shops. Okay.
Yes. Agreed.
Which is the whole reason why we went with AP, because I can do 300-400 backers on Kickstarter, but Niobe Origins sold almost 2,500 copies through AP to people that probably don't even know what Kickstarter is.
Right. That's like, how do you market?
Seeing Niobe for the very first time when they go buy their Batman book and Niobe's right beside, and they go, oh, this looks kind of cool. And they pick it up. You know what I mean? If we're so lucky to be carried, you know?
Mm-hmm. My question is, are you marketing to those people, or do you want to market to those people?
Well, my question is how do you market to those people?
Right.
Because all the marketing I do is on my Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter, right. But it's to the same sort of group of people that's been following me all along, right?
But that's not what marketing is entirely. Also, that's part of it, absolutely. But your content, too, sometimes. Like your videos, I think the clips that you're doing, Larry, I think those absolutely hit that comic book shop market. Like, oh, he's talking about Rob Liefeld. Oh, he's talking about this. Oh, he's talking about that. Oh, he's talking about X-Men 97.
Yeah.
Cool. But I think when the content gets into the minutiae of like, okay, bro, I love you to death, but when Sam comes on and starts talking about his numbers, you know, for my marketing, you know, his inside baseball minutiae about, you know, crowdfunding and stuff like that, no one who goes to comic book shops, and I don't want to say they don't want to hear it, but they just don't get it. It goes over their heads and they kind of, And in this day and age's attention span, which is zero, they flip to something else. You know, cats, kids getting hit in the nuts, stuff like that, you know, because that's what I do. So, you know, what do you think different content? So, you know, stay like longer videos about more run-of-the-mill stuff that leads into indie stuff. Is that gonna help you? Like, I'm not trying to do actual marketing numbers here because I'm not that guy.
Well, you're talking about me producing content, but there's another way that we can do this, right? JD brought it up. He talked about comic book shop news, right? I used to get comic book shop news every week, you know, whenever they had it, they would throw it in my little bag in my file and I would get it. And for whatever reason, I don't know why, it's been a few years since my shop's had it. They just don't do it anymore. I don't even know if they still have comic book shop news. You know what I mean?
My shop has a podcast.
Yeah, it still exists. It's still out there.
But I mean, like, it'd be great if we can get Antarctic Press Books mentioning comic book shop news as a way to market. Right. A little bit more advertising, whether it's a newsletter or, you know, little promotional posters that, you know, could be seen where people buy comic books. You know, free comic book day. I know that's an expensive one. Mm-hmm. But if AP was to put out a free comic book day of one of their hottest comics, maybe that would work a little bit, you know, like... Ben, what is AP doing in regards to marketing, to your knowledge of, you know, in the upcoming year to try and, you know, push it forward?
Well, I don't know what they're really doing, to be honest. I assume they just do the website. And I don't really know if they have any type of, you know, quote unquote marketing. And I think I do most of their promotion, to be honest. I mean, I post stuff on Facebook and, you know, let people know what's going on. But beyond that, I don't think we do much as far as promotion is concerned, other than just what we do in previews.
Right.
And what we do online.
Maybe that's an area we can work on.
Together. You know, to do promotion takes money.
I know, but sometimes you got to spend money to make money, brother. You know what I mean?
I know, but... I guess the attitude toward Antarctic Press is that we let the work speak for itself, so to speak, you know, and if there's a demand for the work, people will discover it, you know. I mean, the thing is about the direct market is that the retailer, I mean, retailers control the direct market, you know, the comic book stores, you know, and the people who run the comic book stores are the ones who decide, you know, what's going to go on their shelves. So the only way for us to really make an impact is that if you have an inordinate amount of people come into the store, you're asking for a particular product or a particular thing, you know, in which case, well, gosh, the retailer has to, you know, meet demand. Now, it always really made me feel, you know, kind of discombobulated when, there's an obvious demand for our books in some areas, but they'll still only order exactly what, you know, their customers, what they subscribe to. So they won't order any for the shelves, you know, basically. And so that means that the books don't get any exposure. I mean, the thing about the shelf is that when people come in, they see it, you know, and they'll be curious enough to want to pick it up. Now, the thing about crowdfunding is that you're selling direct to consumer. Now that, you can look at sort of Kickstarter as sort of like a big, huge digital shelf. You know, you're looking at stuff and perusing, looking for particular items, and if something catches your eye, you'll support it. You know, the only advantage the comic book store has is that it's immediate. You see something on the shelf, and you can pick it up right there on the spot. You know, and then you take it home with you. But with crowdfunding, it could be months, maybe even years before you see a particular project get into your hands. You know, and by that time, you may have forgotten it or you don't care anymore, you know. And so the main advantage of the shelf is that it's the immediacy of it all. You know, you can just pick it up and walk home with it. Now, as far as AP is concerned, we figured a long time ago that most retailers, they don't really give a crap about independent comics. I mean, their attitude is if it was just Marvel and DC, they'd be perfectly fine with that. They would have no problem if all the other comic book publishers would just disappear tomorrow. You know, the thing is that we have to convince them that they'll make money if they support independent comics. We gotta get to the point where we can start to sell. Now, you know, what's the image? I guess it's image. They're doing the Transformers and G.I. Joe. Is that what they're doing?
Yeah, Skybound. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, Skybound. You know, and they're making headway. You know, they're making their retailers are taking notice of the sales.
You know? Yeah, but that's a 40-year-old IP. You know.
That's correct. Yeah, it's an IP that they're familiar with. And that there's a demand for. Yeah, but it's still an independent publisher. You know, and anytime you can sell outside of Marvel and DC, that's good for the independents, because that tells them you don't have to be Marvel or DC to sell comics. You know,
we got Crooked Painter in the chat saying I should hire a girl and, you know, booth babe at cons. We've already done that, and I didn't need to hire her. She promptly volunteered for the role.
Yeah, that's really good, because, you know, that brings attention to your product.
That was back in the day when booth bays were still sort of kind of allowed. You know what I mean?
They're not in vogue anymore, really.
No, they're kind of shunned upon now.
Ben, I will tell you this. At my comic book shop, I mean, I JD can attest to this. I'm out of Long Island. I'm pretty lucky. I have like 7 or 8 really solid, thriving comic book shops. Mine that I've gone to for over 40 years, Fourth World in Smithtown, not only carries exciting comics, they only get a couple issues. They don't get a ton, but they have people who have been shopping there for a long time get it. But anytime I've asked them for something from AP, they're just going to computer. Do you have the number? No, but it's blah, blah, blah. Okay. Tap, tap, tap. Okay. It'll be here in a week or two. Thanks a lot. No problem. And they get it for me. And then they end up getting an extra one just in case. And then because I've had some pinups and stuff, like the 8 pages that we did, that all of us did in the Pinguina Adelaide, they got me my 2 and my 2 sketch covers, but then they got a couple extra ones because I'm in a book and that's my shop. And they were like, oh, cool, we'll carry some of your books and some of the pinup stuff. So they, I don't know, because I heard people say a lot of shops, oh, they won't even order it. My guys will order whatever you want as long as you're buying it.
Yeah, well, and that's a good comic store.
We appreciate that. You know, what we try to, you know, there's one thing that independent comics have that Marvel and DC doesn't have is that we have flexibility.
Yes.
We can pivot, we can change, you know, almost overnight. You know, if something is popular, you know, we can do a comic, you know, the very next month. You know, it's one of those things. See, Marvel and DC are the big companies. They're more ponderous. You know, they can't change and like we can. You know?
Yeah, except here's the thing. Customers are ponderous.
That's
correct. Customers are as slow moving as Marvel and DC.
Right. We're not really going to appeal to the people who read Marvel and DC.
Well, I don't think that's necessarily true either. I think it's just more that the people that buy Marvel and DC, by and large, wear blinders. They buy the X-Men, they buy the Avengers, they buy Spider-Man. That's all they're even looking for. Like, they just don't care what else exists. Now, there are still people all the time, because I go to cons and, you know, I talk to people all the time and they buy all this stuff and they're still looking for our stuff. But the percentage of that is so low that it's really hard for a retailer to just suddenly decide, hey, I want to start doing indie stuff, if his client base, his customer base, he can see what it is, particularly over a number of years, if you've been in business for a long time, he knows what his customers want. And if they don't ask for AP, then there's not really a reason for him to carry AP, et cetera, Scout, Vault, whatever. And so that's where we run into the problem of how do we get indies on the shelf? It's we have to convert the retailer as much as we have to convert the customer.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Yeah. I mean, but the thing about it is that why does Marvel and DC have the market share that they have? Okay. What is it about them that makes us any different than what we're doing?
Well, it's, we just said with Transformers, they've existed for 75 years. They inundate all media, not just comics, but movies and TV and video games and t-shirts and Hot Wheels cars and everything. They are the culture. And so for us, we are the counterculture to a degree. And, you know, you have to appeal to a different almost personality type to get the counterculture people to see what's happening on the other side of the wall. Otherwise, the people that are there, they're just like, well, Spider-Man's here. Well, hey, they just did a new Ultimate Universe. Let's start that Ultimate Universe. Well, let's do this. And so, and in the case of Marvel and DC, right, those are the top of the heap superheroes. So whenever there's new superhero stuff that comes on the market, they're like, well, I already buy superheroes from Marvel and DC, so why do I need Critter? Why do I need this? Why do I need that? There are people that look for things outside of what Marvel and DC do, of course. But the way that Marvel and DC do their marketing, they inundate everything. Bleeding Cool and what are all the other places? Newsarama and whatever, comic, whatever the sites are. They just constantly flood you with Marvel news and tell you why it's so great that Gwen Stacy is now the freaking Green Goblin. Like, that's the thing. That's the third part of the equation, is we have to get those guys that are excited about nothing to get excited about us.
Yeah.
and talk about us.
It's the Green Goblin symbiote. So yeah, that's what that is.
It's
trash.
It's all bad. but those guys are the hype machine for Marvel and DC. And so that's why whenever you go to these websites, that's the story. This is like what you guys were talking about earlier when Larry does his little mini shows about X-Men 97 or whatever, right? He taps into that awareness, which hopefully brings some people back to Larry himself and not just the talk about X-Men 97. And they're like, oh, hey, Larry's talking about X-Men 97, but hey, what else does he do? Oh, he does his own comic. Maybe that'll be cool. So we need that's the third part of this triumvirate is, we need the news people, to talk us up. Like in the old days, it used to be Wizard would be like, oh, hey, look, Valiant is awesome. Oh, hey, look, Defiant Comics is awesome. You know, we don't have that anymore. That we have no hype men other than ourselves now, right, for the most part. I mean, obviously there are podcasts and stuff that do that on a very small level, but none of the big guys, that have the large traffic really talk about us.
Well, I may be out of the loop, so I have no idea who these big guys you're talking about are. I assume you're talking about newspaper or...
No, all the websites that talk about comics all the time, like Bleeding Cool and comic. What's the one, Comic Book Resources and, you know, all that kind of stuff. There's sort of the main places that talk about news. I mean, there's news everywhere now. But even in that, even when I go and I see stuff like on TikTok, people are still just talking about X-Men 97 and, you know, whatever's in the comics. I unless it's coming from the creator himself or one of the creators involved in it, I never see someone talking about Zenoscope or Aspen or whatever, unless it comes from an Aspen direct source. So, you know, we've lost the media, widely. We've lost the media. And so now our media is very scattered and small and in all sorts of little tiny circles and groups talk about things, but there's no large scale talk.
Why do you think that is?
It's a good question. I mean, part of it I would assume is due to, the perceived indie bubble pop, you know, in the late 90s, where it was like, hey, this stuff doesn't matter because look what happened. You know, but people don't understand that was also just a hype machine in and of itself at the time. It's everything's worth $1 million right now, you know, and that's why print runs were so ridiculous. And everybody thought they're going to put their kids through college on these new indie books and whatever. And it's like, no, dummies, you're printing 1 million units. This is not going to have value, you know, in any significant way. So it was the hype that brought it up there, along with all the speculation. And then when it popped, there was sort of an inverted understanding of like, oh, well, we wasted our time with this stuff, so why are we going to come back and deal with any of this now? Oh, Valiant's back? Yeah, but look what happened last time. You know, so who are these guys that are doing things, particularly companies that are coming in with names that nobody knows, right? It's one thing for like this Ghost Machine thing that's happening at Image, right? Because it's a bunch of big name people doing a thing. But when it's a bunch of people that nobody knows who they are, it's hard to hype up the unknown. And that was what, you know, kind of Wizard was sort of good at, is essentially just bullshitting and being like, yo, you want to see what this is? Go see what this is. But we don't have that anymore in a focused sense. Everything that we have indie marketing is all splintered. And, you know, JD does a show, and Larry does a show, and I sometimes do a show. And, you know, there's all these little tiny shows, but nothing is really hyper-focused to push all of us.
if I could just present, like, it's not so much counter to what Tom is saying, but it's an aside. Like, one of the other issues that we have is that, you know, a lot of these retailers came up as Marvel and DC fans, right? So those are the only things they know, and those are the structures they stick to. And they know that's where they're making a bulk of their money. They're like, why should we worry about indie comics? Indie comics comprises outside, and I'm not including Image. So outside of Marvel, DC, Image, indie comics is 20% of the market, right? But in that, you have Dynamite, Dark Horse, Boom, all those other companies, Viz, so on and so forth. That's probably 16, 17% of the company, of the industry. Yeah. And the rest of us is like 4%. And they just don't want to take that risk, right? And like Tom was saying, you know, nobody knows who we are. And that's unfortunate. And I was telling Larry earlier before you guys jumped in, since we're micro-publishing, right? We're printing 500 books, 600 books, 700 books, whatever it is, right? It's micro. You know, that's just what it is. And the only way we can get back to those bigger numbers is by getting books into the hands of, you know, fans. And it's going to be hard, you know, because like I said, I have something that I want to do. I'm hoping I can execute sometime towards the end of this year. Do something quarterly on a regular basis, and you know, and just it be just for independent comic books. I'm not interested, you know, like I might cover some Dark Horse stuff, some Fantagraphics stuff, some stuff like that, but I'm not gonna cover DC, I'm not gonna cover Marvel, I'm not gonna cover Image, maybe, you understand? Because you know, in the end, they are independent producers, and there's some creators in there, like. You know, they're not selling like a million copies. And, you know, some of them are selling 5,000-6,000 copies if they're lucky, you know? So, you know, I mean, it's one of those things. And like I said, it has to be cheap to get into the hands of the retailers so that they can give it away or they can sell it for a buck, you know, whatever, or they can just give it away. And I think that's important. They have to be able to get it into the hands of fans and just, you know, be able to push that out to them. Just so fans can know, like, oh, like these things exist. Because unfortunately, for the most part, most of these fans, I mean, because like you said, everything's fractured. We only have so many hours in the day and like only so much attention. And you have what, 300 books on Kickstarter at any given time. Who the hell has time to go through all that? Right? So, you know, it's fractured as hell, you know? And I mean, to bring it all together is going to be difficult, but you know.
Well, here's the thing. Rome wasn't built in a night, right? And so every time I come out, you guys throw me out here like this. Mind you, you know, we got two pages in a big book, okay? But the more eye-catching these two pages are for these shops, mm-hmm. the more likely they might give something here a chance. You know what I mean? Yeah. Are we going to be selling 10,000 copies overnight? Maybe not even anytime soon. But the more and more, I think, new books that AP pumps out, and we, you know, I just picked up Critter at my local shop. You know, Tom had a nice big week this week, man. Critter in the hands of lots and lots of people. Big things, you know, going on with him and AP. More things in the works, you know. You're coming here, man. We got Scott the Flock. You know, Max has got his properties. We got Nicholas Mueller right up there in the top right with Exciting Comics. I think AP is in a position for a push, right? You know, to level up. Are we talking Image level? No. Are we talking, you know, a step above where it is right now? Yes. You know what I mean? You got Common America, hot selling book, man. Punchline is an awesome book when they get it out. You know what I mean? Patriotica's got a strong, you know, Mount Olympus guys have a strong, strong fan base. Tom comes in with a fan base all of his own already, you know what I mean? That people remember him from Aspen Comics days, you know? On top of the flagship titles, you know, with Fred Perry and Ben Dunn, I see a push that can really be made here, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I want to ask, is Fred coming back? Is he going to start doing more stuff?
Oh, Fred hasn't left. He's still with us.
Okay.
Yeah, he's doing just one shots and mini series now.
Gotcha.
That's what he wanted to do. So, if what Fred wants, he gets.
No, I got you, man. I mean, listen, man. I mean, he's been with you guys for years, and that dude's put out some work.
So. Yeah, we're very impressed, and he's He's been with us since 1989.
Damn. Yeah. I was 15 in 1989. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we must have been doing something right if you stayed with us this long.
That's it. Mm-hmm. And guys, I don't have this open by accident. Please, all month long, you can order these books. Chill time, right? Go get Outbreak 1, cover A, B, or C here at your local comic shop. A, drawn by Juan Antonio. Cover B, by the man on this panel right here, Mr. Ben Dunn. Of course, Ben Dunn is going to be on our Antarctic press release. And the hot seller for Outbreak number 1. Was Paul Green and Ulla Moss Antarctic asked if we can run this cover. I said, absolutely. Let's sell some books. You know what I mean? So there we go. We also got Tomorrow Girl, number 6 in the trade paperback down there as well. We got Freakier Than Normal. I put that on my pull list. I'll be checking that out. We got Jungle Comics. You asked about Fred Perry. He is here. He's got right now Gold Digger, War Mistress of Mars. This is a 4-part miniseries that he's pumping out. Fantasy Comics, and of course our good friend Nicholas Mueller. AP guys, it's growing.
We are trying.
It is growing though, Ben. You, like, think about like what you managed to bring on just in the last year or two alone.
Yeah, well, I mean, we've always been very proud of all the creators we've had. You know, it's one of those things we try to foster a you know, a good working relationship with whatever creator works for us. You know, the main thing for us is just to be honest and upfront, you know, make sure that we, you know, take care of whatever concerns they may have, you know, and just try to treat them like people, you know. And so it's always interesting to me because I've met with a lot of publishers and creators and things like that over the years. And it seems like there's almost an antagonistic relationship between publishers and creators. It's almost like if the publishers don't care about their creators. They just only look at them as just mere dollar signs.
That is all they look at. I mean, you can see that obviously through some of these, I will not name names, but you can see some of these publishers that aren't paying people and so on. It's like, they're not there to promote comics and stuff. They're there to try and find that one in a million Hollywood option that'll put money in you know, in pockets that might not even go to the pockets of the creator that much. So kind of it's kind of shady. I mean, I'll say this, like, I've talked forever how email is the bane of my existence. I hate email. And all my AP correspondence is like, oh, email this guy. I'm like, no, motherfuckers, no. I'm on Facebook. Someone message me, please. And Brian finally was just like, let's just do it on Facebook. I'm like, yes. Yes, Brian. And so now he and I are like super easy back and forth.
I tried to do that with him, and then man, he wanted email, so okay, we do it by email, I guess. I did push for that Facebook option though.
I talked to Tom on TikTok. It's just easier. He's there more.
He's there on TikTok a lot, is he?
Messenger. When there's Messenger, you get notifications of Messenger. If it's email, you have to go look at your email and see what's there.
I have a ritual. I guess I'm the only one that has a ritual when it comes to my email and stuff. Maybe, like, here's the thing. When I get up in the day, there's like 4 sites I immediately open up. First one is Facebook. Second one is Twitter. Third one is YouTube. And the fourth one is my email.
Nope.
Those are the 4 things that I go to right away. Cause the emails, I want to see if I got any sales, my eBay, Gumroad, things like that. If I got any orders to do, you know,
I'm just going to say it for Tom. It's his Venmo, and the other one is Pornhub.
It's Facebook is first. It's NFL.com is second. It's eBay is third. And then it's generally like my Patreon, just to see if people are chatting on Patreon, something like that. That's it.
NFL and baseball references always open.
What about you, JD? What's your first few things you open when you get up in the day?
Email is first.
Yeah,
that's where I do most of my
business.
You're
so old, JD. You're so old.
yes.
Email. Oh my.
Are you a boomer?
Email is first.
Am I a boomer? Huh? Am I a boomer?
We got the flock with us, Scott. What's going on?
Hey, what's going on?
Not much. You say in the chat, I got your book, Tom. Thank you. So you're able to buy this book, right, Scott? Correct me if I'm wrong. For like $5 at a comic book shop, right?
Which book are you referring to? The one that's on the screen right now?
No, no, the Critter number one from Antarctic Press. That's the book.
No, my did not get it, and I called them, so they're gonna order it. But I called them like 2 weeks ago. I'm like, what the heck? Why didn't you show up? But I did get Critter 19.
He won. Yeah, he won a contest a few weeks back. Yeah. We did a contest for Iron Butterfly, and he won a couple of old vintage. Yeah, Critter books. Yeah.
Oh, good, good.
It was awesome. Yeah, it came in great condition too. Awesome.
Beautiful.
Of course, Critter back on shelves right now. You can go to your local comic book shop if they have it. Go grab Critter. If they don't have it, ask them if they can maybe possibly back order it and track it down somehow and
slap them in the face.
But you know,
let them know who's boss.
Kickstarter, man, is rolling on. You guys mentioned someone, you know, 300 campaigns on Kickstarter. That's a lot, eh?
Yeah, it's been flopping around the 300 mark the last couple of weeks. It's less right now, but it's still really on the high side of the average.
Well, right now we're looking at Maggie's Grace issue 1, a Lovecraftian horror fantasy. JD, man, you want to tell me a little bit about it?
All right, so this is about Magi's Grace. They're a team of monster hunting, demon hunting, cryptid hunting. Duo. She's a sorceress. He's a warrior. And basically, they get together. Whenever there's an issue between cryptids and the magical world, these are the two people they call in to deal with those issues.
All right.
And that's basically it. And this cover was done by C. Michael Lanning.
Shout out to C. Michael Lanning. Of course, that is the other half of Nita over there at the Comic Indie Network.
Yes, it is. You know, and so, you know, he did this new cover for it, which is really cool. I really like that cover.
Yeah, it's really almost Street Fighter-y feel, you know, like something like you would see from Udon comics, you know. That's a good thing.
And if you scroll down, I was showing you this. That cover was based on this.
Oh my Gucci-ness.
So this is La Blue Girl number 3.
Yeah.
Cover to our own book. And like I said, I was telling Larry earlier, this is the first book that I ever wrote that I got paid for. Like, this was my first professional work. So I was like, you know, as an homage to that, I figured we would do one of those for Magi's Grace.
So that's the second book where someone has homaged themselves. The first being Savage Sin cover that John Stinsman did for Larry.
Oh, there you go.
Where he homaged himself. So
I said, John, let's homage. He's like, well, who do you want to homage? I'm like, you. What do you mean?
There you go. Exactly. We're going to homage anybody.
I think his answer was, and I'm going to do the very bad Tom McFarlane, John Stinsman impression. I don't know if I ever homaged myself before.
I bet you Todd homages himself every night.
Whoa.
Oh wow!
After the bullshit of the contest, I can say whatever the fuck I want about it.
Hey, that La Blue Girl book's going for like $25 on eBay, man.
There you go.
You looked that up really fast, Tom.
Yeah, these.
I know how to use eBay.
Obviously. As a matter of fact, I have 3 or 4 copies that I may get. I'm gonna probably get Matt to come over. I might have him sign them and remark them, and I might put them up on the camera.
Yeah, man, this shit's pricey.
Yeah. All of them are. I mean, I was surprised.
Well, I like that one.
That's Narcilio Souza. He's been doing excellent work lately. You know what I mean? Like,
I like that. Her hair is just everything right now.
In fact, he's the cover artist for Tom's Critter release through Antarctic.
Yeah. Oh, no shit.
Yeah.
Nice. He's doing all, he does all the A covers. He is locked in to do the series.
So like,
when do you lock in, when do you make him exclusive so Larry can't use him anymore, Tom?
He's too fast. I can't. I don't have enough shit for him to do.
Someone did try to lock him in. He had told me that, and he's like, yeah, someone wants me to be exclusive for a year, but I don't know if I want to do it. I said, well, whatever you want to do, you know, you got my support.
I'm gonna send him a message right now.
You got all the greatest hits on this one, JD. You got Sousa too.
And I'm like, look, man, if you get tied up for a year, let me know right now, because I want to make sure I get a cover from you before you're done, you know what I mean, for a year. So this is the other Sousa, by the way, Joel Sousa. I don't know if they're related or what, man. I gotta ask. No, one's with an S and one's with a Z.
Yeah.
Or Z.
And I think one is Brazilian and the other one might be Colombian. I'm not sure. Don't quote me.
But they're both great, man. They're both great.
Oh, yeah. They're both incredible.
Got some good choices. You're running with a lot of naughty, JD.
I like the dude.
JD's been problematic for a long time, okay, guys?
Long time.
Been
but is this like sort of like your first not safe for work Kickstarter? Because usually you're known for pretty much all ages stuff, right?
Yeah, yeah, that was always the OsmoCon. As a matter of fact, this is running, if you look, this is Angel Wing Productions. And then Oswald runs through Dreamweaver Press.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's nifty. Yeah. I see what you did. I like that. It's like tagging a different wall with a different name, but it's still you. I get it.
Right, right.
Well, that's like Pat Shan. Pat Shan does all of his cheeky stuff under a different different banner as well.
Now, who's doing all the art here, JD?
This is all C. Michael Lanning.
All C. Michael, okay.
Yeah, C. Michael Lanning did all the interiors. He is my partner. And the colors are done by... Holy shit, I'm drawing a blank. hold on.
I'm sure we got
a great colorist.
Some dude here you know.
No, he's not some dude. Edgar Tavares. That's
what's his name?
Edgar Tavares.
Edgar Tavares.
Yeah. So yeah, Edgar's awesome. He's a great colorist. I found him. You know, I really liked his pairing with C. Michael stuff. So you know, we got them.
So there's like three in each set. Is that what this is?
Yeah, so you're gonna get the standard cover. You get a I don't have him. I should have grabbed him. And then you get a prismatic foil version, and you get the regular version.
So how many versions are there per cover?
Three, except some of the earlier ones, like C. Michael's. I think only has one of them has two, and then the other one just has like there's two of them that there's just one of each. Like this cover.
Yeah.
That cover just has one. It's all one by itself. And this cover just has one. Matt's covers. Yeah.
So there's a trick people have been doing, and I don't know if this, you know, you would want to do this or not, but a lot of people lately, when it comes to not safe for work comics, they're actually putting it in brackets in the title, not safe for work.
Oh, gotcha. Well, yeah, I
mean, because they're marketing to that crowd. So someone who's going to be flipping through the Kickstarter, right, is going to see this, right? And maybe, you know, most of them, they're looking for not safe for work. You know, I've gotten messages from people, hey, is Niobe going to be not safe for work? No, sorry, bud, you're out of luck. You know what I mean? They're looking, right? So some people will put in brackets, you know, not
NSFW.
And,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well,
have you noticed that, Tom?
I've heard lots of people talking about that. If you put certain things in your title, you know, the people that are looking for it, the thirsty guys will come looking.
Yeah.
I mean, this one, like, I have some naughty covers, but that's it. The interior is pretty, you know.
But that doesn't matter. Most of these guys are buying covers anyway.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So anything that you, if you have anything that's NSFW, just drop NSFW in your little, you know, thing. And,
If it was me, I definitely do, because I would want it, you know, because you're doing it anyway, so you might as well cash in, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. No, of course. Because later on, I have, because after this one, because coming out through Angel Wing, I have this, I have Dreamweaver's coming out next, and then after that, I have Girls of Terror X, and it's Girls of Terror XXX. So that one is NSFW all the way.
That's not a nerd alert. That's a perv alert.
That's a perv alert. For sure. For certain. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, we did that one while we were doing La Blue. We did those just as a group.
This Joel Souza image would be a good thumbnail for the campaign, too. You could have this right here and then have the logo smaller down over here somewhere. You know what I mean? Because you're going to want to switch that this thumbnail out every so often, you know, with something new to catch the eye. And you don't have a logo in here. Tom has, like, ridiculed people for not having a logo in their thumbnail.
Oh, yeah. JD knows. I've torn him down.
Okay. Yeah, just, you know.
And as
this is at least a good dramatic image.
Oh, for sure.
Monster face and stuff. Like, that's a good eye-catching image, if nothing else.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, guys, it's Magi's Grace issue 1, man, on Kickstarter. Right meow, man. Go ahead and back it. You know.
And- If you scroll down a little, no, in the opposite direction, keep going down. No, well, not the in the body. Yeah, there you go. Keep going. Well, stop. Go up. It's in between these two spots. Well, anyway, there's a link in there. There's a guy. He did a review of Magi's Grace, and so if you have any questions, there you go. That's the review. So if you have any questions as to what's going on, or if you whether or not it might be something you might enjoy, check out the review.
Yeah.
You know, the guy did one.
I was kind of hoping it was like a video review and we would have watched it, but.
Yeah, no. But yeah, it's just a written review. But he goes through it. He gives it it has a porn level, gore level, adventure level, that sort of thing. It's pretty funny.
I dropped review quotes into my story for Crit, mm-hmm. like in between the sections of you know information or whatever. It was just it says right. like read a review and just like a little couple of sentences. Mm-hmm. Now no one ever said anything about it. Like, oh, that was a really cool thing, but. You know, again, you know, the Critter campaign did way better than I expected. So who knows? Those kinds of things might instill a little bit of confidence in your buyer.
Now, Tom, I was watching you on JD's show, right? The one that just went by that we were sort of talking about, you know, indies moving into the direct market. And I remember when we first sort of talked, you were like, yeah, I kind of been there, done that, don't need to do it. And then after a while, you know, you change of heart, you came over. And then on the show, you were talking about, you know, how you believe that your Kickstarter was pretty successful and you attributed some of that to the possibility of being in the direct market in AP, right?
Sure. Yeah. But it's a potential. I have absolutely no direct evidence of that. But the only thing that was different between what I did for all my other campaigns up until that point was we had been talking about AP and Critter and AP specifically, not just that I was talking about it. But AP was talking about it, you know, that would be on their Facebook page and stuff. You know, there were people that were excited about it coming out through retail stores. And so, you know, who knows what that means? Again, there's no direct evidence, but we did do about $5,000 more than I expected. So,
well, Ben, have you guys been getting any feedback on some of these new books you've been bringing in? Have you, like, does anyone write AP fan letters, or do people come up to you at a convention and say, I just got this Niobe or this Critter or Mary Machine Gun? Like, have you heard anything on the skeet?
Nah, nobody writes the letters anymore. We don't have a bulletin board, so we have no idea. But I will say the one indicator is that we've been getting a large amount of reorders. So that to me tells me that retailers are selling out, or they got demand. You know, the only reason that we would get any type of reorder activity is if the product is moving. You know, and that's a good indicator that people are at least. You know, for the first issue, we've been getting a lot of we've been getting a lot of activity on it. You know, and that's to us is a good indicator. Because usually, you know, for books, you know, for our comics, we get very little reorder activity. You know, and if something really resonates with retailers or consumers, then we get people, they sell out. And that to us is a really good sign.
No, it's a good sign. It's too. It means more money.
Yeah, are you selling directly to retailers, or is it going through Diamond?
It goes through Diamond. Diamond handles retail reorder. We don't. Of course, if a retailer did come to us and say we want to order direct from you, we would definitely accept it. But almost all our reorder activity is through Diamond now.
Okay, that's good that they're doing that, because for the longest time they wouldn't issue reorders anybody.
Right? Now,
except if you were Marvel DC.
Like, you don't have to give us the nitty gritty, Ben, but you can give us a rough idea. Like, I assume in the last couple of years that AP has seen some growth in the amount of sales with the influx of sort of some new titles coming in. Like, has it been a overly positive thing for AP to have, you know, gone this route of, you know, grabbing some crowdfunded books and throwing them up on the shelf?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, nothing says confidence to a retailer when you actually solicit your book and you come out with it.
Right.
You know, because you'd be surprised how that how that's an issue with a lot of retailers. You know, when they order the books and they don't come out on time, that really
battle
hurts.
Chasers. Battle Chasers. Again.
Yeah, that really hurts them. I mean, that's what really killed, that's what killed Valiant. You know, that is when they didn't get their damn books out on time. You know, and you know, or Image. That's what killed Image too, or at least the superhero line. You know, so I mean, it's when they didn't get their books out on time. That's what caused the whole 90s crash. You know, is when retailers ordered all these books and they were so late, you know, that the window of opportunity. And that's the one thing we like at, you know, I'm not saying that our place was not perfect in trying to get books out on time. And we had problems with that when just like anybody else. You know, that's why we instituted the policy of the book has to be complete before we're solicited. And that's where crowdfunding comes in, because more likely than not, when a crowdfunder project is funded, it's very likely that they've been that it's complete. And that to us is what is important is as far as, you know, accepting new projects is concerned.
I got a nice message the other day from a Fatal J. He was thanking me for the introduction. He said that he had submitted Ninja Blast to you, and he was all excited to tell me about it, Ben. So, shout out.
Yeah, I got it.
Perfect, man. And listen, you know, you talk about late books. You know, we're all still looking for it, Ben.
Looking for what?
It's on the screen.
Oh, sorry.
That's an oldie but a goodie.
Hold on.
That boat's saying.
Right?
that got torpedoed.
What was it again?
You can't see the screen, Ben? Are you on a phone or a computer?
We don't know where he's at, man.
Oh, yeah. If he's on his phone, he's not going to be able to see that.
Trying to see if he'll respond to us. Oh, he's
that
gone.
He
was probably on a phone.
Is,
so the story is, this came out during the COVID era, right? And everything was late. There was all kinds of shipping problems. And we waited almost like, man, 4 or 5 months for this thing to actually come out when I thought it was going to come out. It was just that late. And so we made this meme, just a joke. You know, we found it. It's on the shipping container out in the Pacific Ocean.
Or maybe the Somali pirates got it.
Right? You know?
That means a bunch of guys on an aircraft carrier, U.S. aircraft carrier, are reading it now.
But eventually it came through. So, you know. And I got to say, since then, books seem to be relatively on time through AP, you know. You can't always go by the date that you see in the previews website, because it's always going to tell you the end of the month sort of thing. And it could be a little bit before that. It could be a little bit after that. You know what I mean? Like this listing here, as an example, is going to say April 27th. I can guarantee you this did not come out on April 27th. You know what I mean?
Right.
Guaranteed.
You know what's... Tom, I don't know if you know. I know Ben would know, but he's got it.
He'll be back, and in larger numbers.
But what is it? Like what's the latitude these days? Because I know what is it? They were given 60-day window at Diamond for publishers to get in their stuff, or was it?
Oh, before it's too late.
Before they cancel.
Yeah. I would imagine it's probably 60 days. You probably get 2 months. I don't know because I don't deal directly with them, but that would be my assumption.
Right.
Yeah, you guys hear Brian Polito is making a fucking PS5 game?
Yeah, he has that kind of money.
He's making a fucking Lady Death PlayStation 5 game. He's going to be kickstarting it next month.
Good for him.
PlayStation 5, you should do PlayStation 2 and just fuck with people.
No. Like I saw the mock-up. He had posted the mock-up, and I thought maybe he was just fucking around. No, this looks like the real deal. You know what I mean? Like, I have no idea if it's going to be any good or not. I mean, I remember buying into the Lady Death DVD and was kind of disappointed with that. You know what I mean? But a video game, you know, is that sort of the future of, like, we all need to be thinking of, like, where we carry our shit to the next level? Now, it's Brian Polito, you know, like you said, he's got the money to sort of invest and do that. But, you know,
well,
people...
he has the brand. It's like we said with earlier with Marvel, right? It's those guys exist because they have, they're everywhere in media. So anytime you have the opportunity to do something external...
No, you're good, Ben. It's my fault. I made you try and look at something.
anytime you have the opportunity to do something external, you know, like the Critter toy, right? Like,
right.
You know, it's it puts your IP into a different perception. It's not that you're just a comic. It's not that you're just a creator guy making your own comic. It's like, oh, shit, that's like a real toy. Like, what the hell's going on? Oh, shit, that's like a statue. Like, oh, that's crazy. Oh, there's T-shirts. Like, anytime you get you take your product into larger media sources, you change the perception of your entire brand.
Do you think I should go with – should I contact Funko Pop?
No, they don't care.
No, that's not true. You can order. You got $20,000 in burn. They'll take you $20,000.
Will they?
Oh yeah. I think it was either 20 or 30. I don't remember, but I know they would print up. I think it was like 10,000 units, and it was like 20 or 30K.
If it was 20K, and I can get my own Niobe Funko Pops and crowdfund that shit, I would think about it. You know what I mean?
Go reach out to their marketing department. You never know. I'm serious, because I know they were doing that for a while. Like, you could go in and they would design it to your design or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, I don't know how the company is running these days, because I know they were having issues. But
you know, you talked about like different ways to market, and I guess, you know, branding into other merch may be a way to do that, right? You know, mm-hmm. Brian Polito.
Yeah, merch is wildly expensive.
Well, this is the problem.
You have to be really, really careful how you're stepping into that stuff.
Well,
you know,
I mean,
that's why a lot of merch now is just print on demand. You know, you just go into like Redbubble and stuff, and you can just be like, oh, I want to put an image on a mug, you know, and it's all print on demand. You don't make much off of it, but you don't also have no upfront costs. It's just uploading images.
Well, you would know something about that, because you dove into the toy world. You were contacted by the people that make the toys for Lady Death and Dynamite, and they said, hey, let's do something. You went ahead and did that. You found out firsthand how expensive that was going to be. You know, how expensive? Mm-hmm. It was like 30 grand, something like that, just to get started?
Yeah, it was 35 grand just for the toys and shit. I mean, like, that doesn't include your shipping or, you know, anything.
Right.
And that's printing a thousand units, basically. So, and we had to print 1,000 units to get the price point down to that. Because if we had only done like 500, it might have been like $50 a figure cost, you know, something like that. So I was like, Jesus Christ. I mean, I can't, there's no retail. I asked him, I was like, look, Brian Polito sells these things about $65-$70. That's sort of the general acceptable price point at retail for these things. I can't be higher than that. So what do we have to do to get it to that point? And they were like, well, this many units. And then, of course, if we were to do like 5,000 units, it would come way down. But I don't have 5,000 people to sell these things to. So,
well, how has been the sale of these toys? Like, you made your first batch, right? You got them out to the backers. It took a little while. But, you know, when it finally went down, everyone got it, and they looked great. I'm actually scrolling through your Facebook now to find a picture of one that we can show to people.
Yeah, and everybody that got them loves them. They're fantastic. I mean, immediately people were like, what's next? Where's the next toy? I'm like, Jesus Christ, we just finished this.
My question is like,
breathe for a minute.
Like, you talked about this maybe opening up new doors. You're stepping into a new world. Has that been the experience since you've had this toy out? Can you walk me through? Like,
well, no, not really, not yet, because we haven't. Part of it is the visual, right? And so once when we got these things finally out to consumers, because I wanted to get them out to consumers first, we really didn't have many conventions after that to kind of like display and be like, hey, look, we got toys, and like make a big deal out of it. So now that we're coming into this year, I'll be taking, you know, a case of each of these things to the Comic-Cons and making a big deal out of it. So now we'll see kind of what the perception is, how it changes a little bit as we get into this year. Because last year it came out and I only had like 2 shows left in the year, so I didn't get to go big on it. But you know, I've ultimately, the people that got them were thrilled with them, and so that's the key. And And even the guys, executive rep, because they were like, what are you doing next? I was like, shit, can I get this one out first, please? But they want to do more. So we were already talking about doing another one for next year. So, you know, I it's expensive, but there was a good response. I wouldn't say it was a great response. I kind of was expecting more people to get in on it. But at the same time, also, I realized that Critter is an odd brand. It's not like if I were to do the Dorothy Gale figure, right? We have an instant Oz connection. There's an Oz like door that would blow wide open for that. So Critter, we did it because it was easy. We could redo the paint apps very easily, make two versions, and I figured we'd tap into sort of like the superhero group, the anime group, the, you know, all those kind of guys. So, and that's what happened. That's exactly what happened. And now we get to see kind of the back end retail of this now that we get to take them to the cons.
Ben,
how many do you have left over?
Not quite half. We sold about half through Kickstarter.
Why would you consider offering them through Diamond?
No. I mean, I guess I shouldn't say no. I have a sense that if I only have 250 of each,
would that even be enough for Diamond? Like, fuck, you know what I mean?
You know, and plus the other thing is that I'd have to sell it to them at wholesale. You know what I mean?
So yeah, you'd be losing money.
I'm not losing money because it's
It's already paid for, but yeah.
Yeah. But you know, like for example, Ben, if we were to do it through AP, we'd have to do it at a point where you guys got some kind of a cut, and then I got some kind of, you know what I mean? It would be a weird financial thing. And then if we got orders for more than 250, we'd be screwed.
Well, do you have a SRP on it?
Basically, it's being sold for $65 to $70. Is SRP?
Just offer $60 to $75. I mean, even if you sold like a dozen or two, that's still.
Well, I can't sell them at 70 and have them be retailing them for 100.
No. Well, what you do is that you find out what your SRP will be. Then, of course, yes, you have to get a discount if you want to sell through Diamond. I'm just saying it's one of those things that it could be worked out.
Well, but, Ben,
you know, if you don't feel like you need to do that, then that's fine.
Let me ask you, Ben, though, right? AP has toyed with the idea, no pun intended, of doing toys. You guys have dabbled in that world a little bit. You brought it up to me recently in a private chat. You know, have I ever thought about doing a toy? And I'm like, the only way I would want to do a toy or statues if I can make them look like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, anything's possible these days.
Well, I'm sure it's possible. I don't know if I got enough people that would come for this. But, I mean, what is AP's position on, you know, doing merch outside of comics? I know you guys got a little bit of a T-shirt line. Are you working or dabbling or thinking about anything else?
Well, the biggest problem with toys is that we just don't think there's enough of a market for the type of toys we'd be offering.
Right.
You know, the thing about it is that the direct market is not a huge toy-selling market. You know, and that's the biggest problem is that you simply will not sell enough in the direct market to justify the cost. You know, and that's the biggest problem. You know, and so that's why we haven't really done it. You know, but an action figure is a little different than say like a PVC or a statue,
right?
You know, being and that you can charge a high dollar amount for those. You know, and people wouldn't bat an eye, you know. But for as far as an action figure is concerned, you know, people have a certain perception and they have a certain, an idea where a price point should be. So it is difficult. I won't say, but I just offered. I was just asking for Tom because he already has them made. They're available. You know, I don't know what his long term plans are as far as the excess inventory he has, but if he wanted to simply just get rid of them, then you know Diamond might be a good choice.
Well, but if I were to do it through Diamond and they would be like, yeah, give us 500 of each, I'd be like, well, nope.
Well, then
I have 250 of each left, maybe.
Well, if you sold 500, then you just have to allocate. I mean, we've done that before in the past.
Yeah. Well, no, what you do is when you list them, Diamond has things that are in limited amount. You know what I mean? There are only 100 of this available, and you say, I have X amount, you know, if you really want to get around that, right? Yeah, but I think Tom's too. Bound to make more money just bringing them to conventions, to be honest with you. You know what I mean?
Yes, he probably could. All I'm saying is that it would alleviate any excess inventory, thus, sure. You know, eliminating storage costs. You know, that, and you wouldn't have to be dragging them around the conventions, you know, to try to sell them piecemeal. You get the money all at once.
Yeah, for me, the value, though, is having them.
Right, of course.
Because it's an attractor. It's a display. Even if I only saw, like, two at a time.
Right.
It's like somebody walks by the booth and they're like, you got Critter Toys? Like, what is that? Like, that's, even if they don't buy it, it's an icebreaker. It's an immediate eyeball grabber.
If I could get something like this done, right, and this is the Ethan Van Sciver, you know, PVC frog toy, right? It doesn't move. It doesn't do anything.
Yeah, those are even easier because they're just little mini plastic statues.
Right, but, you know, it looks cool in the box, right? Like, I would need a box with the Niobe logo and the cool art on it and all that sort of stuff, right? You know, that could be something worth doing, maybe. You know, I don't even know how expensive it is to put something like this together, you know?
Well, it would be much cheaper because there's no articulation. You're just making a mold of the thing.
Well, he talks about how much they cost all the time.
Yeah, but he
complains how expensive.
Well, that's what I'm worried about. You know, how expensive are you? You know?
It depends. You know, depending on what you are asking on the toy and the level of detail and how... You know, the biggest thing is articulation. You know, the more articulation is necessary, the higher the cost.
I'll tell you what I really want. Here, I'm going to show you what I really, really want.
Tell me what you want. He wants
a Niobe body pillow.
No.
Well, that's easy. You can do that.
It's the simplest thing you can make.
I have to put her back on her stand. But I would love to have statues like this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know. It doesn't even need to be an action figure, like these sort of like Japanese like statues of like the X-Men and stuff that you see. I forget the name of it. It starts with a K. There's a one.
Kotobukiya.
Thank you. Yeah. That style, I would sell these for Niobe. They would look badass. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I'm gonna tell you, Larry, that's so perfectly up your alley too. I know many friends and myself personally have had to block that website from all my browsers, and I'm not allowed to go near the booth at New York Comic Con. Because I'll go home with like four or five. They're just money.
Well, I have a collection of them, right? And they're all female. There's only one male. And it's
Cyclops. Shocker. Shocker.
Yeah, and it's Cyclops. He runs the fucking harem. You know what I mean? Like,
right. He's the man.
But they're money. They're money, though.
This is it.
They're absolute money.
Some of them are worth money. Like, they go out of print, yes. and I still got the boxes for all of them and shit. I got them all out on display, but yeah. And R2-D2 sits behind. Well, yeah.
I'm kidding. I'm not that guy.
I didn't take Cyberfrog out of the box, though. He's still fucking trapped in there.
That's... They did a great Scarlet G.I. Joe one of those. That mm-hmm. It's awesome.
She's got all the pouches and stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, man, if anyone's got a lead on how I can get a hold of X Company, you guys just said.
Go to book. Yeah.
I would love to talk to them.
Another option is to just get a 3D printer.
Yeah, but then we have to hand paint them or find someone to paint them, I don't want these things to be done individually. Like, I want to be able to mass produce. You know what I mean? Like,
I literally have a guy.
Yeah, the 3D printing and the sculpting. I mean, that's almost the easy part. It's you want to have it's the paint apps that you want to be really really good, and then you know you want to be able to make a few hundred of them with a box.
Yeah, not looking like make 10 of something. You know what I mean? I'm talking like you know at least 100.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. And that's the only way to get a price point down for your retail is you got to make a few hundred of those things at least.
I mean, it'd be a Kickstarter thing, you know what I mean? And
sure,
then
of course.
And then it'd just be like an add-on for every Kickstarter I ever do afterwards until they were all
exactly
gone.
Right. Yeah, I sold a bunch of Critter Toys on the last campaign.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's it. Scott, you got a campaign going on, don't you, brother?
He's not even there.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. I'm going to bring it up, Scott. I was like, you know, I'm going to give him some minutes and like he's yes. Scott, it's the Flock Sidekick Adventures, brother. Let's play the video. Here we go. All right, Scott, you know the drill. Lay it on to us, man. What's going on here?
It would help if I unmuted myself. So this is the Flex Sidekick Adventures. This is our one of our characters from the Flock series. It's called the Gosling. And basically, this is a bunch of anthology stories around that centered around that character. The book is finished, which is awesome going into this campaign. The story is the Gosling finds a dog and names it Slinger, and they go out on adventures and fight crime in the city. It's very much an all-ages book. The cool thing about this anthology setup is one of our major fans is a six-year-old, and she wrote a story and submitted it, and then we included it in the book. So one of her scripts is actually in the book as well. We have a couple variant covers, one by one of the panel members here, Ben Dunn, which is awesome. We got our standard cover by our sequential artist as well. And we've got a lot of cool extras. Once we hit some certain goals, we got blank variants available. It is very much a all ages, golden age style storytelling. It's very kid friendly, a lot of action and adventure, something that you can give to your brother, sister, niece, nephew, you know, anyone who's starting to read as well. It's a great book for that as well. But we got a lot of cool stuff coming post this book, and it's already finished. I know I've said that before, but it's
a good selling point.
Ready to go.
You know what I mean? When would you look at fulfilling it?
As soon as campaign's over. I mean, as soon as the campaign's finished, we'll fulfill it. But if you know, printing is already ready to go. I have some of the books already in the house, so it shouldn't take very long to ship out to. It's just putting stuff together and shipping it out to people.
So Scott, you're pretty much on the same sort of time frame I'm at. You got basically a week left. Yours says 8 days, mine says 7, going on 6. You're 52% funded, guys. We really need a jump start for Scott here. You know, I keep saying that your last week is just as important as your first week for these last minute backers to sort of come in. And this is when Scott really needs to be posting and pushing and reminding people this is out here, and he's doing that. I'm going to put the link in the chat. And guys, I want you to come over and check out The Flock. I think the biggest selling point to this is that it's an all ages book. You know, I hear often that there's not enough all ages books. They want books that they can give to the kids. People are, you know, there's a side of the aisle that says that they're sick of, you know, all these not safe for work books on Kickstarter. Well, guys, if that's it, man, then it's right here. Yeah. Here's your answer. You know what I mean? Come get The Flock, you know?
Most definitely. Thank you.
And like, you're bringing The Flock, you know, right, Ben, over to Antarctic. This is happening.
Yes, indeed. It'll be exciting comics.
Yeah. Do we know whenabouts we might see that come to fruition?
I don't have the details in front of me, but it'll be soon.
Ben, how can you be my AP insider and have no inside knowledge?
I don't have my schedule in front of me right now, this very moment.
I'm just giving you a hard time, sir, man. Yeah.
The last time you said, Ben, when you messaged me, it was going to be in April. I'm just kidding. No, I think you said originally it was September, and then when you guys went back to monthly, you changed it to, I think, a little bit sooner than that, but I don't know what month it was.
Yeah, I don't remember offhand, but I can probably find out soon enough.
So Ben, I'll tell you this, you know, when the guys, you know, contacted you and you, you know, decided to do a cover for them, agreed to do the cover for them, both of these cats, Scott and Ichthys, were over the moon, dude, to be able to have the bragging rights that they got a Ben Dunn cover. And on top of that, for Ichthys to color it, I think Ichthys did a really good job with this piece, brother. Ichthys, if you're out there, you know, shout out to you.
Yeah.
What inspiration did you take, you know, when it came to drawing the Gosling and Slinger here? Did it take you long to figure out what you wanted to do? Or, you know, was this... You put pen to paper and you know, it was the first sketch you did. Like, talk to me a little bit about the process, man.
I just wanted to do something that was, showcase the character, you know, and show them he was, that it was sort of a all ages type of book, and just show that it was a fun and adventure type thing. So, you know, it was pretty easy to figure it out, and I had a really good time doing it. So,
have you found yourself in doing a lot of these covers for people now? Like you know, like I'm sure you're used to just doing your own stuff, and now, you know, you've been hanging out with us a little bit, and we've all been sort of hitting you up. You know what I mean? Are you yeah. getting lots of requests for covers and stuff, Ben?
Not really. I mean, to be honest, I never really consider myself that great a cover artist. You know, I get by, you know, but it takes a long time for me to do a cover, and I try to focus more on trying to just get interiors done. You know,
I mean, Ben, that's saying, Ben, you saying, and I'm just going to speak for everybody here and who's listening or who's read AP books or has the How to Draw Manga books like I do. You saying, oh, you know, I just get by when I do a cover. I'm not really that good at it. Is the understatement of the month. I'm just the shit.
Well, actually, I want to put Ben Dunn on the spot right now. Yeah. You know what I mean? I was going to ask him later, you know, but. I'll ask him now, Ben. I got this campaign coming up, right? It's Niobe number 2, the second printing. We're changing it from black and white. We're giving it color. We're having it relettered, redesigned, and I need a variant cover for it, Ben.
Well, you know me. I'm always willing to do one for you.
Perfect. And the idea is, I want you to draw me like a savage looking Avani. She's the blue skin chick, the villain.
Yeah. Yeah, she's a great character.
I want her to nice close-up shot of her, you know what I mean? Almost like you know, ready to tear your head off like she was Wolverine or something, you know?
All right.
All right.
That sounds great.
All right, brother. You let me know what the damage is on that, and I'll hook you up a little later, but you're on the clock now, sir.
That's Larry's version of La Blue Girl.
Yeah, well, right. She certainly is a blue girl, man. You know what I mean?
Right, I'm just saying.
I'm only running a few covers. Like, I'm running, you know, the two main covers that we had. I'm running Narcilio's covers, and then I'll be running Ben's cover. And that's probably the cover lineup, maybe a sketch variant. Like, it's going to be a small, like, 3-week campaign, you know. I don't expect it to do, you know, large amounts. It's a reprint. It's going to be a cool reprint, though. It's going to be in color, you know. It's like...
That's solid as hell.
Going to have some great covers, you know what I mean?
I have a question for the panel.
Yeah, bro, you go ahead.
Flip it around a little bit. I know we all do him. Even you, Larry, you'll do him again soon. Starting with JD, because you're the most local to me, so we'll probably be at some of these. Any show appearances coming up? Show cons?
No.
Okay.
I'm thinking maybe New York Comic Con later in the year. But
okay.
That's it. I'm like,
okay.
Like I've said it before, man. I like to stay in my pajamas.
No, I feel you. Well, I'll shoot you a message. I got some stuff that's in the boroughs later on in May, later on, and one in Nassau County later on in May and June, especially since it looks like there's a window open. It looks like there's no Eternal Con this year. So
there's no Eternal Con this year?
I don't know yet. There's a lot of rumors going around. So we'll see what happens.
I know the people to reach out to.
Yeah, me too.
I know the promoter.
Yeah, no, me too. Me too. So it's scary. I haven't heard. It's.
Did we just have a Me Too moment on show?
No, in a bad way.
Okay.
But yeah, it's getting a little scary. Dom, anything coming up?
Starting with Free Comic Book Day, the first weekend of May, I'll have eight. Events in 6 weeks.
Yeah, buddy, isn't it great?
No.
Oh, if it makes you feel better, I have no. I at the middle of April, I have 3 in 1 week in 10 days, so it's great. I'm excited. No, I'm excited. One's a fun anime show. Then I got a gallery show in Brooklyn. Well, it's not even a gallery; it's an underground thing. And then another fun show in out here on the island. Scott, are you going to anything? I know you went to a couple weeks ago.
I am doing a. Local comic book shop we're doing because for Free Comic Book Day we're doing like a mini convention where all local people are coming and doing like kind of like a the comic book shop is like in like an actual mall, so we're like,
ooh, that's
and
the, cool.
So the well kind of the oh. store that it would used to be like the actual big store that used to be next to the comic book shop is no longer there, so it's an empty spot, but we're able to spread out and take over section around the store. So we're going to be able to do that for Free Comic Book Day. And I think we're doing it the day before too. But yeah, it's going to be a good time. I'm going to be handing out free comics. Some of the old black and white versions of The Flock is going to be available at that day. So well, it's going to be a lot of cool stuff.
To anybody doing Free Comic Book Day stuff this month, I have some space open in my calendar. Not that I'm going to fly out to you and do your Free Comic Book Day, but if anybody would want a print, like I could send you a digital something that you could print up and hand out for free, you know, free of charge, just to get you sketching, just to get you something to hand out to the kiddies at Free Comic Book Day. I'm willing to offer that to you guys because you guys here on the panel have always been there for me, so I appreciate it.
There you go, man. I mean, for me, nothing yet.
Yeah, that's why I'm saving you for last. I know you. Yeah, it there's bubbles. It's like the water's about to start boiling soon for Larry.
It looks that way, but we'll see what happens. You know, I got a couple of people that are advocating for my return to the local scene, and they're fighting hard for me, and they're making posts on their actually, the convention, you know, had a post, shout out to them, for, you know, local Canadian guys who are in Previews magazine, and they graciously included my name in that and gave me a shout out. So it's a good sign.
Well, I saved Ben for last only because I need to know what's coming up in Texas so I can start putting things down on my calendar so I can start calling them. Because I want my goal, like, okay, before the pandemic, my goal was get to C2E2, get to C2E2, get to C2E2. And I got to C2E2, the one before COVID, but I got to C2E2, right? So now my goal for 2025 is I want to do at least 2 to 3 shows in Texas because I just hear nothing. My buddy Bun Leong, I know Tom, you know Bun. Just like, you got to get to Texas. You got to get, because he says, I got to get to East, to Emerald City, but I'm never getting into Emerald City. But I want to go to Texas. So, Ben, what's coming up for you, if anything?
Well, let's see. I got a local show in April called Dallas Comic Show. And then after that, I think San Diego, I think.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, if you're in Dallas, you look me up.
No, that's the plan. I'm looking at the calendar and I'm trying to see what that, because the Texas, it's something weird. It's actually, I hear everyone talking about, I mean, you hear the normal, you know, shows that people talk about, but everybody else always talks about the show. A lot of the shows in Texas, Dragon Con and MegaCon, which I'm never getting into. And then some of the stuff in Michigan, Detroit and stuff like that. And I'm like, I got it. I have to take the travel ban off myself and start traveling out and doing out-of-state stuff again, and New Jersey doesn't count because it's fucking New Jersey. So it just doesn't count. So, yeah, that's the idea. So I'm always curious to know, especially from Tom and Ben, what's going on in your area so I can start calling out for next year and seeing what's going on.
Making a big plot. You're going to do a world tour. You're going to come to Canada. Bro, we'll hang out.
Fat Guy Inc. is a studio. At the height, right before everything, like 2019, because there's two of us. My buddy didn't travel too much, so he was able to do a lot of the New Jersey and Long Island and New York stuff. While if there was a show at the same time, say, you know, like he was at a local thing when I was at C2E2. So we were able to split the squad, you know, two fat guys spread out a lot more, you know what I mean? So, like, at one point, we were doing something like 70 shows a year as a studio. You know, somebody would be like, oh, did I see you guys at Baltimore Comic Con? He'd be like, no, you saw Pete. And somebody would be like, oh, at the thing in Queen City. I was like, no, that was Brendan. You know, it was really cool. And we'd really kind of, this year I have to give him a little bit of a break because he is getting married right after New York Comic Con. So I'm going to give my partner a bit of a break. But after that, we're full guns blazing again, trying to get back out on the road. And hopefully by then I'll have a car that I can, you know, drive to some of these things and possibly sleep in lieu of a hotel. So...
We'll all get rooms. We're all part. You know, we need Antarctic Press Con. That's what we need.
As long as I have a gym membership, I can go take a shower or whatever. It'll be
fine. And it's like we'll be in like this small fucking remote town in Antarctica, and there's like 3 people there for our convention. You know, bunch of fucking penguins fucking wandering around out front. You know what I mean?
It's gonna be mad expensive.
Right. On a show is way a lot of logistics going on.
Fucking Eskimo shows up. So you guys with the comic books, eh?
So many logistics.
We put on a show back in the 90s, and it was just way too much work and effort. I mean, you could do it if that's what you do all full time, but You know, it's a. I just don't think we could run a publishing company and run a convention at the same time.
You'd need a department, a separate department to do
it. Yeah. It's
just absolutely. Doing that.
Yeah. It just, you know, yeah. Too much.
I mean, I put on a little rinky dink thing at a brewery, and the only thing that saves my life is there's very little to no moving parts about it, you know, right? But you still, the bullshit you have to, like, I literally had an artist call me up. It's like 4 days before the show. Hey, I just tested positive for COVID. That's not going to be a problem, right? I paused for a second. I said, no, it's not going to be a problem. Let me refund you.
Use some common sense, man.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah, it's a logistical nightmare.
So, I mean, it can be done. I know a lot. In fact, yes, just yesterday, I interviewed a guy who puts on shows here in the state, and he told me all sorts of stories about, you know, putting on shows and stuff like that.
It's yeah. Tough.
Well, it's in of itself, it's not that difficult. It's just handling the actual running of the convention. I mean, it's not that hard to, you know, get a venue and stuff. But the hard part is trying to get people to sign up to come to your show, to set up at your show, then mm-hmm. getting a list of guests, you know, and then having to handle those guests, you know, and then dealing with all, you know, the public at large. He was telling me, man, you know, people come to those shows, they can get pretty nasty, you know,
I've seen it firsthand, like some of the, and it's really funny, the people that you, like, celebrity guests, there are some, like, okay, I was at a show, they had Rutger Hauer, right, and they said people handling him and helping out with stuff, he was a dream. At one point, he was riding around in a tricycle around the convention floor. They said he was a dream to work with, nicest guy in the world, blah, blah, blah. But then, you know, a couple weeks later in Jersey, there was a show, and literally, a guy whose claim to fame was he was like zombie from episode 7 and 8 of season 2 of Walking Dead was like an asshole asking for things, and I blah, 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 and don't forget my contract, and don't forget my guarantee, and blah, 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 blah. Like, you were a zombie in 2 episodes of The Walking Dead, dude.
Like, right?
Like, come on. Like, I don't get it. Something, but, you know, it is what it is, you know, whatever.
Yeah, and you know, and the problem is they're pretty pricey to put on too. So mm-hmm. you gotta make sure that you know you gotta balance mm-hmm. all that stuff when putting on a show. So it's just too much trouble.
Insurance now is a killer too.
Yeah, and security and all
security,
that
security. Kind of, yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's ridiculous.
It's tough. It's a dance. It's a hell of a dance. But if you have other things that you're cooking on, you really don't need to.
Yeah, if
that
I put
dance.
On a show, it would be invitation only.
Oh, okay, like a quiet curated thing. See, yeah. that's a little easier. There's an art show I do, and that's what it is. It's a curated thing, and they have a whole thing, and I love that cover, and I'm gonna let Larry get to it. But it's a lot easier. This is my favorite one out of the 3 covers that you have with that pose.
Well, this is for the second printing of Niobe. This is. Narcilio Souza's cover with the ladies in dresses, you know. It's kind of sort of my new kick right now.
I like it so much. I didn't even notice it. I forget who it was the other night that noticed it, that Niobe doesn't have her pink on her eyes. I'm like, wow. But it's still her, which is really cool.
Mm-hmm. Ben will be the last cover for that. And we'll probably run that Kickstarter a couple weeks after this one sort of ends, you know. Depending on how much work we get done. I don't want to like fulfill 2 things at once, but I think I'm allowed to have up to 6 if I really want to. I'm not quite sure how that works.
Hey, are you guys going to see Ghostbusters?
No,
really?
It's so boring.
Oh my God.
It's so boring.
Wow.
Same shit, different day.
That's exactly right. It's
Tom, you've seen it, right?
It's just, yeah. It's just the same jokes and the same situations and the same. It's just the same, you know. Somebody, I was talking to somebody the other day. He's a big Ghostbusters fan. We were talking about this, and he brought up this term of comfort viewing. And I was like, dude, listen, I'm a Godzilla fan. I understand comfort viewing because that shit's the same all the time. I get it. But in the context of like the Ghostbusters, like there's the same, and then there's literally just using the same lines that we used last time. And that's what this new movie is. It's just how many times, like there's literally a scene where fucking Paul Rudd is like singing the Ghostbusters song. I'm like, oh my God, come on. This is, I understand meta, guys, but let's move on
and evolve this, you know, concept somehow. But it's like it's so trapped in its nostalgia that it doesn't know how to do anything other than what it's already done. So yes, comfort viewing, 100%. If you're just there to just kind of zone out and listen to the sounds and hear the same things, you'll be fine. But if you're looking for anything that's got some evolution of concept and so on, there's just nothing there.
Listen to the sounds of pouring rain.
That does not bode well for Ghostbusters on the Andor scale. It just does.
Oh God, they're oh God. We could just rename it the Ghostbusters scale because it's like
this. That's fantastic. How about this? Do you think it'll be better or worse than the two movies ago that completely shit the bed? The one with Melissa McCarthy in it and shit like that.
Ugh.
Because that was horrible.
It was horrible. I don't know which is better.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Like, could it be worse than that?
I think the reason with that the first one, or that the 2016 was horrible because it didn't know what it wanted to be. It was trying to be a reboot, a retcon, its own thing. Like, it didn't know what it wanted to be or how it wanted to do it. And so it just missed every swing of the bat that it took. This one knew exactly what it wanted to be, which is just the same. And they were like, well, let's just keep doing what we're doing because the last one worked. But the last one I understood, even though it too was in most cases kind of the same, it was there to close out the original story with Zool and the Ironworks guy. It was there to give a tribute to Harold Ramis, which was a really well done. Yep. So it had a point and it evolved. It passed the torch to this new group of people. And then you're like, okay, well, so now we've closed the door. Now we go into some sort of a new dynamic. But no, it's just, it does. It felt like every time I watch these guys walk on screen in the suits, I was like, I'm watching a cosplay movie. Like this, none of this is landing at all. I don't believe anything that I'm seeing. So yeah, it's like, is it a terrible movie? No, but it's just not, there's nothing there if you want like escalation of concept.
I kind of felt there was no demand for it either.
Well, I mean, after the last one,
it existed until it was fucking out. So yeah.
After the last one, there's no doubt that there's, you know, a demand for Ghostbusters stuff. And I mean, it's not like the Ghostbusters have disappeared. They've been video games and comic books.
Right.
I mean, they've not gone away. So, you know, it was disappointing that we didn't get the last movie with Harold, that it took so long that one of these dudes actually died. That's really the tragedy. Cause what could have been had they all just been able to get on the same page, you know, 20 years ago, but, you know,
they would have been younger and done more shit.
That's right. Would have been incredible. But you know
what's incredible? The month of June. June is looking incredible, Ben. First Comics News has released the Antarctic Press June 2024 solicitations. And we're going to have a look and see what's going to be in the upcoming preview magazine. First, starting with, hide that, Winnie the Pooh Demon Hunter, number one. So, initially, this was going to be in Manga Z. There was a muck-up in Manga Z. And now it looks like Winnie the Pooh Demon Hunter, Antarctic Press, four-part miniseries from Nicholas Mueller. Ben, talk to me.
Or not.
Ben. He's speechless about
This is Winnie the Pooh Demon Hunter. Oh.
Well, you know, it's Winnie the Pooh.
Well, you know, we want to make it up to Nick, and he had a really
shut
good
up, Todd.
Hey, bud, I'll do my bit done the way I want to, bud.
Todd's can't. Todd, I don't hear Todd anymore. I'm mad at Todd. He's on timeout. He's
gone. Demon, Todd's on timeout. Demon Poo. Winnie the Pooh. Demon Poo.
That was me the other night, Demon Poo.
Demon Poo. Winnie the Pooh, Demon Hunter, man, coming to Antarctic Press. This is what we're talking about, you know. Nick's got a complete story. Doesn't have to be always sexy girls. It could be a fucking murderous, rampaging Disney fucking character with a chainsaw.
On steroids.
It can be these things, you know. Right, Ben?
What was that again? I got cut off.
We're looking at the June solicits for Antarctic Press, and the first one on the list is Winnie the Pooh Demon Hunter, 1 out of 4 by Nicholas Mueller.
Yeah, we, I mean, like I said, I fucked up and I didn't, so, you know, the art, we to make up for it, we just say, well, why don't we just give them a miniseries, you know, and we actually sort of glad that we did it. I mean, I think we're getting a lot of good positive buzz on it, and we think that it'll do pretty well. So
this is what I'm talking about, right? Like when I had my arguments with Level Two and shit, right? It's like, look, man, to me, it doesn't matter who comes in if they're bringing something to the table, because if Winnie the Pooh Demon Hunter gets more people buying Antarctic Press, right? And they're buying this book, and then they're flipping through the book, and they get to the back of the book, and they see a nice big two-page ad for all the other AP books, which includes mine and Tom's and Max's and Scott's and Sam's and whoever else. That is a fucking plus.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I want to see, man. You know what I mean? And this is how we grow. Man, we're going to grow, but it's going to be fucking like we're crawling like a baby. Like a fucking baby. But we're going to get there step by step by step by step. You know what I mean? Here's another cover for the release right here. So you guys are actually running two covers for this for June.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like this one better.
Do you like that one better? Why. I kind of like the first one. I don't know why. I think this one's going to sell more.
Yeah, I actually like that one too.
The other one's better. It's yeah. It's got a Kung Fu Panda vibe to it too.
Yeah,
he's using the thing, cutting through the bamboo. Like that's a dynamic cover right there.
Mm-hmm. I'll bet you a dollar, Larry.
I think this one here is good for issue one, though. You know, here's you just get.
Well, nothing wrong with it, but if you're going to compare the two, I think the other one's just more dynamic.
Well, let's compare two, because you know who else is available in the month of June? It's Mr. Tom Hutchinson on the panel with Critter number 3, Narcilio Souza cover A here. Boom.
No, that's the B cover.
Well, they got it all fucked up.
Yep, they do.
Boom. Walk me through it, Tom. Third issue already, man, in previews.
Third issue, yeah. It's cool. Like we said earlier, Narcilio is doing all the story covers. So this issue introduces Tidepool, who ends up being a big bad guy later on too.
Cyberpunk.
That these solicits were out, or is this your first time seeing it?
Yeah, I saw this a few days ago. I knew that it had popped. Yeah.
Yo, Critter got back, bro.
Yeah, right.
I'm saying.
Well, it's like, you know, they robbed us of Rogue's booty. So, I mean, Tom had to, you know, give it back.
Yeah,
to
the well, you know, that's Narcilio. Like we talked about earlier, Narcilio will give you what you need.
Well, it's probably number one, it's problematic. Number two, okay.
but is it really though? Is it
it's a running joke with show. But it's it's something I expect to see, you know, walking out of a bodega, you know, 7 at night after coming from the club.
Talk to me about cover B, Tom.
Yeah, so on cover B, I decided we're gonna start doing basically spotlighting some of the other characters. Because I don't want just Critter on everything. I want to show that this is a universe that she exists in. So all the B covers now, at least for a little while, will be some sort of spotlight like this. So villain spotlight, this is Mascara. She gets introduced in issue 2, but she's also still in issue 3. She's a big part of it. And then issue 4, we'll have a hero spotlight for Charity. And that one just got turned in. New artist Terry Parr is doing covers for me. He just turned that one in. That'll be part of issue 4. So as we go forward now, Narcilio will be doing story covers, and then we'll have a guest artist doing some sort of character spotlights like this.
Good idea, man. I like that.
So, it gives me a Miley Cyrus vibe.
Guys, I'm going to put the diamond order code for Tom's book here and a couple of these other ones into the chat. You know, this is what you do. You go to your local comic book shop. You say, hey, man. I want to order these books. These are Antarctic Press books. Why in the fuck don't you have Antarctic Press books? What's your fucking problem, man? I'm going to start shooting someone.
Yeah, Larry, you tell them.
I don't know if they need to go that far, but, you know, let it be known that there are some cool books out there that you want shop maybe to pick up on. I can't find my chat. I might have closed it out by accident.
Come to Long Island, Ben. We got tons of AP on Long Island and Queens.
Awesome.
Hey guys, I'm going to get back into the chat here. Just give me one second. I'll give you all the links you need, man. You guys got any questions out there? If you're still lurking, you want to ask JD or Ben or Tom? Anyone questions but me? You're more than welcome to do that.
Why, Larry? Why?
Why? You know, just to see if anyone's got something to say before we slowly wrap the rest of this up, man, you know?
Well, no, that's my question to you. Why?
Why? Why not?
Why? Okay. All right. That's fine.
It's like both. That's fine by me. You know what else is coming out? No. And he's also on the panel.
Oh, shit.
Ninja High School, number 195, Alfred Perez and Mr. Ben Dunn. Ben, you're closing in on that 200th issue. Talk to me about issue 195. What can we expect?
Well, I'm going to do some story-centric, character-driven stories, you know, focusing on the main characters. That's the one thing I didn't really get to do when we introduced the characters, you know, way back in 177, was to focus on the origins of these characters, and that's what I'm going to start doing.
Who's the little eyeball in dude's hair?
That's a little Japanese ghost demon, you know.
Is she, and, who's going to kill it in my miniseries?
She's got to step on it like a bug.
Just hold still, kid. This won't hurt. I promise.
I thought the little one on the corner in front of it. Yeah, I see. I thought that was either something from Hogwarts, or it was like an English soccer fan going to a game. So I was like, what's going on?
Now, let me ask you, did Nick Webb color this?
Dylan did.
Dylan colored this one.
Okay. Dylan Fagan, yes. He's actually a Japanese manga character called Gege no Kitaro. He's been around since the 60s. You know, he's sort of like a ghost hunting, he's like a ghost hunter. You know, so this is my sort of like homage to that character.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
That's absolutely fantastic.
You're also on this again because now we have Ben Dunn with Jim Faulkner here. Ninjas versus Aliens, the trade paperback.
Shit, I need that.
Talk to me about Ninjas versus Aliens, Ben.
Oh, well, that was a series as a backup that appeared in Ninja High School, but it never finished in Ninja High School. So, you know, well, actually,
speaking of stories that never made it, you know, I got something to ask you hereafter.
Yeah. Finally I finished it and then, put it as a Kickstarter. And then, what AP does a lot is whenever I do a Kickstarter, they like to go ahead and, print when I print my Kickstarter, they also add to the print run. You know, and then this way they can solicit later on down the line.
Very good. Very good. Also, we got Planet Comics number 29. You guys still obviously looking for stories for Planet Comics, I assume?
Oh, yes. We are definitely. I'm desperate for.
Talk to me about what you would like to see for Planet Comics, man.
Well, for Planet, I mean, I've been getting a lot of hard sci-fi stories. I'd like to do more space fantasy type stories, you know, things like that. I don't get very much of those, you know, but I would love to have them. You know, something what I really would like to have is like an anchor series, you know, to keep the book going for a while, you know. But like we did with Shaman Kane, this is the last issue that he appears in for a while.
Okay.
So, you know, I would like something similar to that, where you have sort of an anchor character to, you know, keep the series going, to have some sort of continuity, you know. But yeah, I'm always, if you have a science fiction story or a space fantasy story, send it in to me.
We also have Freakier Than Normal. You know much about this one, Ben?
I have no idea about that one. That was I think that was a Brian pickup, so I have no idea.
I added the first one to my pull list. I'm like, give me issue number one, because I just, you know, it's a new AP book. It's a mini series. You know, I want to do my part. I hope I like it. It says, be careful what you wish for. Don't tell me that, man. After escaping from the alien ship, Maya prepares to use her powers against crime while Jigsaw tries to keep everything a secret so the situation doesn't get worse. In shops, June 26th. And, of course, we talked about this with JD. The World's Finest Furries, Furlog number 195. So Ben, talk to me about bringing this back. And I didn't realize there's 195 issues. What the hell's going on here, bro?
Well, we started the series way back in the early 90s, and it ran for a good while. But then in around 1999, there was like a big market crash, you know, for comics. And we had let go a whole bunch of people, you know, and one of the editors of Furlough, one of the severance packages we gave to them was they were allowed to continue furlough and all the various furry titles that we had, and under a new company that they had started. So they ran it for quite some time. You know, I mean, they ran it for a long time. Mm-hmm. And but then they went out of business, and the title was in limbo. So we decided to go ahead and take the title back and restart the line.
Did you just decide to do it and not ask anyone, or did you contact these people? Was there a negotiation, or?
Yeah, there was a negotiation. We don't do that.
So hey, no one's using Exciting Comics. Okay, we are now.
Well, yeah, it was abandoned, so we figured no one's going
to
be.
Well, that's what I was wondering. If this was essentially abandoned, or did you have to go through steps to get
it? No, it was not abandoned. It, you know, we had every right to take it back, you know, but we didn't feel that we asked the editor of the series that we would like to have it back, and this is what we'll give you in exchange for it, you know. So they said, okay, sure, and then we got it back. So we. Are bringing, you know, we noticed there are not very many furry books on the comic stands anymore, and we sort of want to fill that niche. So
of the new line, this one right here?
This is a continuation of the same numbering.
No, but I mean, like, you know, like, is this the first issue that you guys have published, or is there like a couple others before this?
Oh, no, this is not the first issue we published.
No, I mean now.
Yes. This is the second issue.
The second issue. So there was like one last month?
Mm-hmm. No, okay. About 2 months ago.
About 2 months ago. So restarting with 194, 195. When do we see Furry Tales?
I have it scheduled. I don't know if I got the files yet.
JD, did you send him your stuff?
Did you send me the files yet?
Daphne did, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe it's in my hard drive. I'll need to check.
Double check on that, Ben. Make sure you got that all straight.
Yeah, I got to make sure I got it. If I have it, then everything is cool. If not, then I'll have JD either resend it to me or, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's not JD. It's Daphne. The smart one is going to handle that one.
Oh, yeah, Daphne. So you may see an email that you don't recognize and maybe discard it. Don't do that.
It is possible. I mean, sometimes you get a lot of stuff in spam.
So make sure you
put Messenger is better. Facebook Messenger.
Put in the headline, JD, from JD Calderon. You know?
Yeah. So do I contact you or do I contact her?
Contact her. Because that's I'm hands off with Tall Tales. She handles okay, all that. Well, I don't like get a punch in the mouth while I'm asleep.
Okay. I don't have any I don't believe I have the files. If you could contact her and let her know that I don't have it, have her resend it to me, I would appreciate it.
Send me via Facebook, send me an email, or you can just send me an email.
I'll send it to you now, or Ben can put it in the private chat.
Yeah, then I can.
Because I actually asked Ben that question too. I'm like, what's the best way to get this to you? And Ben gave me the email. You know, I'm gonna throw it in the private chat, and I'll just send it to you on Facebook, JD.
Send it to the Dallas.
Yeah, that's the one I got. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the magic email for Ben Dunn.
Yes.
Because there's been a couple, you know what I mean? So
yeah, well, that's the main one. That's the one I check every day. So if you send that email, you will be guaranteed that I will get it if it doesn't end up in spam.
Okay. So, Ben.
Yes.
What's the first website you check when you wake up?
We're still back to that.
Well, my routine usually is, you know, when I get to the office, I do a YouTube video, and then AP value stamp, and then I Facebook, and then I check my emails.
Okay.
And then I correspond with everyone, and then I work on my pages, and then once I do the pages, then I go back and see if there's anything I need to do AP wise, like put together a book or do a solicitation or, answer any more emails. And then I go home.
Gotcha. No, the question came up earlier. I check my emails first. Like the first thing I do is I check my email.
Yeah, that's about the third or fourth thing I do.
What did you say the first thing you do was?
I'm starting to get into the habit of trying to do at least one YouTube video a day, you know, so that I can try to build up my channel. You know, I'm doing the Richard C. Myers thing, just keeping it simple, no bells or whistles, you know, and I'm trying to learn a little bit more to sort of up my ante, but for now, I'm just doing very simple, you know.
Well, it's been working because I've noticed you're starting to get more viewers, right? If I go to your channel, you got 405 subscribers now. You know that when you get the 500 with 3,000 hours of watch time, Ben, you can start earning super chats for live shows.
Super chats.
Super chats, man. And by the way, if you super chat me a large amount of money, like $100 or more, I will send you out a physical copy of Niobe the Trade Paperback Cover B. I got 5 of them left, man. So, and the reason why it's got to be 100 is because, well, these things are expensive and YouTube's going to take 30%. So, you know.
It's a bargain.
It's not a bargain. I mean, if you're super chatting, you're doing it because you just want to support the channel. Not many people give you something back in return. I try to do that.
When are we going to get a critter value stamp, Ben?
Whoa.
I don't know.
I remember I had to bug him for a Niobe one. So there is a Niobe one out there.
I know I've done a critter value stamp.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, yeah. Well, you need to check. I think I did it way back in the way.
I think you're right. I used to have a bunch of them, but I could never use them for anything. So I do, you know.
Right now I'm going through my Warrior Nun phase, but as soon as I get through that, I'll do a critter stamp.
Well, here's what I like about what you've been doing, Ben. I like the surviving comics videos you've been pumping out. You've only done 2 so far, but I think this is a good series for you, and I think you should keep that up. The other great stuff was how Antarctic Press survived and got started. Like, you did 4 parts of this. Your first one's got 186 views. You know what I mean? That's quite a leap from some of your usual videos, which seem to average around, you know, 30s, 50s, 60s. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, I'm actually kind of surprised by that, to be honest. I didn't think anyone would really be interested in a train of thought.
Your Dune was 235 views so far. That seems to be the king of your channel right now.
Oh, you hated Dune?
No, it was Shotgun.
Did you hate Dune, Ben?
Huh?
Did you hate Dune?
Oh, I didn't hate it. I just didn't think it was all that great. You know, I mean, you know, every other piece was always a masterpiece. It's a masterpiece.
Yeah. Well, people don't understand what masterpiece and perfect. They don't understand those words anymore.
I thought, I mean, I was just being honest. I mean, I thought it was an adequate film. You know, it just lacked color and it lacked a certain amount of epicness.
It's boring.
From a movie like Dune, you know, I thought it'd be.
I'm interpreting his answers. It was boring, guys.
Did you ever read the book?
I have never read. I tried. I really did. I mean, I'm one of those guys that, you know, I'm just not a big book reader. You know, it just, all those words, they intimidate me. So, you know, I'm more of a comic reader. I like comics, you know. If it was a comic, I'd read it.
I found that by reading, because I read the book, when I was like 13, 14 years old.
Same.
I found by reading the book that I find the movies more entertaining because of it, right? Like, that's why I like the 1984 movie. That's why I like this version of the movie. But it's because I've read the book and I can fill in the holes that the movie doesn't provide for me. So,
and it's out, right?
Nostalgic connection to something. Most entertainment nowadays is based on a nostalgic hit.
Well, that's why the X-Men 97 probably works so well.
100%. I mean, yeah. I mean, not that the X-Men was bad back in the day or anything, but yeah, I mean, 100%, you're tapping into a market that is, you know, was wants more of it. And now it seems that Marvel understands that they want more of it, because now here comes an X-Men comic that has them all in the old costumes. It's like, you know.
Shout out to Art Victim throwing down links in the chat. Appreciate that, brother. I didn't see you there, so now I can relax. I don't have to worry. You got the links covered. Crooked Painter's here. He says, damn, new Roadhouse movie. Now, if I see it on, I have to check and see if it's the good one, you know?
I've heard really good things about the Roadhouse.
Really good things about it. They said Jake Gyllenhaal was great.
I heard
Well, that's it. They said Jake was great. But even in the interviews, we're getting a humble Conor McGregor, which is weird. So, yeah, I'm all in.
Shout out to Crooked Painter, the official sponsor of this channel, giving me new duds such as the Eric July has blocked me t-shirt.
See, I thought you were trying to show us your nipple. So
I got that too. You know what I mean?
The Eric July t-shirt, man, brought to us by Crooked Painter, who is in the chat.
So I no one here has seen the new Roadhouse?
I'm probably gonna go Sunday after work.
Okay, you asked me if I've seen the new Roadhouse.
Okay, good. I thought it was in theaters. I paid for that shit already. Then I'll go
How
see
many
it.
More
yeah,
new
I'll
Patrick Swayze movies do I have to see without Patrick Swayze?
Well, he's passed away, so I think it's a nice homage.
Yeah.
So
Next thing you know, it's gonna be Dirty Dancing, the remake. You know,
they did that. They could do that.
Yeah, they did that.
He was in.
Well, then it's not a remake. It's not a reboot.
You know? It's a sequel. It was a sequel. Yeah.
The Point Break was the one that was a piece of shit. That was just garbage.
I think we covered a lot. JD's got to go to work. I'm sure he's looking to get out and bounce out. JD, yeah. Anything you want to say or cover before you go? What should I be looking for? What's the topic, man, on your show in a couple of days? What the hell am I in for?
Let me see. What
do I have to come with questions and shit? Like, that's what you do, right?
Hold on a second, Larry. Look at what he just did. He has notes for his upcoming show.
I always do. I do.
See? Yes. I'm using this as a teaching example for Larry.
Let me see. Mainstream comics. Just isn't doing it anymore. How can indie comics do it better?
We are doing it better. We're already doing it.
That's the subject matter for the lead question. But I'll have like 5 or 6 other questions behind that.
So. Do I have to come up with something? Is that like the game?
No. I have Tim. Tim is my Coco. So
Tim Fling?
You got a Coco. Yes, Mr.
Another another Antarctic Press contributor.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I bought a couple of issues. I forget what comic was. I think it was Planet Comics he was in. He did one of his, Mad Max sort of stories in there. You know what I mean? Like,
His Water Wars stuff.
Water Wars.
I actually really enjoyed.
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, Ben, what's coming up for you, man? You just sort of did the G Rangers Sentai Bikini Kickstarter.
I'm on my last 2 pages of Tomorrow Girl number 6, so I'll be wrapping that up tomorrow. And after that, I'm going to take a little bit of a break to work on some other projects. Like I'm right now working on the Ninja High School Cerebus crossover.
Oh, what's the latest on that? Can you give us any news?
Dave is still on board with it. I'm going to, but he wants to see some layouts of the story. So that's one of the things I'm going to probably be working on over the week. And then I'll try to get as far as I can on that. And then I'm going to start Ninja High School number 195 next week, probably. I gave myself a 2-week window to get that finished. And then I'm putting together the Tomorrow Girl Punchline crossover. We're still doing the Penguina Niobe Tomorrow Girl thing also as well.
Epic.
Nichelle
Fraga still working on that?
I hope so. I've been trying to get a hold of her, but she hasn't replied back, so that's never a good sign. So, but she lives here in the local area, so I could just probably go to her doorstep and say, "Hey, Nichelle, what the hell am I paging? God dang it." I could probably light a fire under her under her fanny to start getting it done. But no, I'm hoping she's working on it. And then of course we're doing an Azrael one shot. Dalen's doing that, and I'm working on a new character called Blue Sonia, which I hope to get started probably sometime later this year.
Blue Sonia. Now you got my attention. What the hell is Blue Sonia?
It's basically Red Sonia with blue hair.
But drawn by you?
Yeah, but basically it's sort of like a manga version.
Yeah, I can picture it already.
And
not to have the blue hair.
She's basically, unlike Red Sonia, who's like this badass, she's like a total ditz, and she's stumbling through this adventure world
You know, basically, it's a female group.
Ben, but I already thought of our new next Superverse crossover.
Are you familiar with Gru?
I am. But here's the crossover I'm proposing. Okay. Blue Sonya with My Savage Sin.
Hell yeah. Let's do it, baby.
That'll be a little bit down the road, but, you know, they're both fantasy chick characters inspired by Red Sonya in many ways.
There you go, man. I'm taking a more humorous approach to, you know, all those fantasy stories, you know. So it's basically like a female version of Gru, like I said. And I'm right now I'm finishing up the story. So I hope to get to work on that sometime around the summertime.
We're joined by Nick Webb. Nick, we're still alive. You usually only jump in the off air. What do you got going on, Nick? Okay.
Not much. I was kind of working on some of my character design stuff while I'm waiting for now I'm a little worried that it's not coming. I thought, like, I'm not sure what project I'm working on anymore. I looked at the chat and I was like, wait a minute, what happened? When did Ben ask me to color something? And I forgot what it was. And I couldn't find it.
Well, you'll be getting pages next week, Nick.
So I'm like, oh,
there you go, man. Of course, JD, he's got his campaign going right now. Scott the Flock Wilson's got a campaign going on right now. Tom, you're what, April 6th, you said, or something?
April 6th, yeah.
What happens on April 6th?
Critter 23.
Damn, Critter 23, man.
Dang.
This is it, man. This is the way.
How many days?
It'll be 3 weeks.
21.
Yeah. I don't want to do 3 weeks, but I'm going to do 3 weeks.
Why don't you want to do 3 weeks?
Because I'm tired of 3 weeks. I'm tired of dead time.
You want to do what?
I want to get through the first week and have it be exciting, and then I want to tell you everybody, hey, 1 week left. And just maintain that, you know. Oh, shit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can tell that. People, 1 week left, man, for Niobe Outbreak number 3. I'm not going to, you know, bore you to death with this. You guys have seen this 1,000 times. But take a scroll through. We got 11 great covers plus a blank variant. Fabio Simeo, John Stinsman, Francesco Tomasi, Greg Bo Watson, Keith Garvey, man. Of course, the man of the hour on the panel right now, Mr. Ben Dunn right here. He's going to be working on a new cover for us for Niobe second print number 2 featuring this blue vixen right here, Avani. We got the Narcilia Souza day to night set. Another dress variant right there. And we got John's cover right here, man. The longest pigtails Niobe's ever rocked, I think, right here, man. All kinds of combos and add-ons and things that you can do. We got even a Paul Green CGC 9.8 slab up for grabs. Here's some preview pages from Juan Antonio and Dan Overa, man. It's bright and colorful and lots of crazy superhero action, man. It's all good stuff. If you're not getting your fix from the X-Men, maybe come over here and check out what we're doing. We're unlocking stretch goals, man. The first 3 are all unlocked. We're on our way towards this one here. We want to get the art victim sticker right here. That'd be nice. We get a nice boost. Everyone's going to be getting this beautiful card from Josh, the amazing animator, featuring Pineapple Pizza Girl and Niobe. He drew that in a matter of a day. I'm like, yeah, let's put that up on the campaign. Everyone can get that. And again, man, if you're missing out on previous Niobe, we got you covered. Don't worry. Scroll through here. There's something for all sorts of tastes. If you like the cheesecake, we got it. If you like action, we got it. Man, if you like it somewhere in between, we got it. We got Jamie Tyndall, Ben Dunn, Greg Bo Watson, cosplay set, Niobe Penguina, the trade paperback, and we just talked about her, Savage Sin, my latest property. Here's some happy backers getting their loot. Guys, it's all going on right now, and I got less than a week left. So help make it happen, Captain. 244 sexy backers strong. We're walking 13,175 Canadian duck bucks, which is getting pretty close to 10K American now, I would say. That's probably almost there. So that's it, man. That's the shills for tonight. Pete, what do you got before we go?
What's going on, everybody? It's Pete. It's me. You guys know where to find me. I would love to do whatever you guys want. Gift, comic book, I don't care. I want to draw stuff. I'm still going to always be drawing stuff, but I'd like to draw stuff for you. So you know where to find me. It's Pete117 everywhere you go. I'm just painting right now, getting ready for a couple. For April, I have like 5 shows in 4 weeks, so I'm kind of excited about that. Plus it's my birthday, plus it's Easter, plus it's baseball and a whole bunch of other stuff. So April's always a fun month for me. Surrounded by a bunch of stuff. But what was I gonna say? Oh, I got a couple links too though. I forgot to share all my links. I shared one of them before. I know it's tough sometimes, especially when you're looking for an artist or a Kickstarter or something. And we understand that times are tough, so maybe you can't buy art from us or, you know, buy back a Kickstarter or something, or can only back digital, and that's cool. Remember, folks, do what Art Victim's doing in the chat. At the very least, and it's free, you can share our stuff so other eyes can see it. That would be freaking cool. And I shared the link. I shared my link tree, which has a tip jar in it too. So, hey, even every dollar helps. Every dollar helps buy me a couple pencils and an eraser.
That's it, man. So with that being said, we're going to see you next time. We always got the one last thing to say.
Tune in tomorrow. Same bat time, same